This is the captain. We have a little problem with our entry sequence, so we may experience some slight turbulence and then explode.
Hello, and welcome to the Black Dog number 153.
Good lord.
I think we're going to call it No Capes. No, that's probably the best thing to call it. My name's Lee.
My name's Darren.
And this week we are, again, thanks to various scheduling things and my wife being several thousand miles away in Africa, we are back on Skype. So if we all sound a bit weird and tinny, then, you know, take that into consideration and don't hurt us. But also because we're on Skype and, you know, why not, we've got Jim on because obviously he's got nothing else to do between publishing books and whatever else he's doing at the moment and recording and podcasting and stuff.
Just being generally brilliant.
Yes, exactly. So, hello, Jim.
Hello.
Hello. And how is everyone this week?
Do you want to start off, Jim, seeing as you is the guest-like in it?
I will. This week I have been mainly faffing around with a broken bathroom. though I'm leaving it to professionals, so...
Yeah.
Instead of a DIY disaster, I've had paperwork disasters.
Oh,
I spent a whole day last week turning the house upside down looking for an insurance policy.
Oh.
Only to discover that I did it online and so therefore it was virtual. And so I didn't actually have it.
Lovely.
So okay. That was a fun day.
Yeah.
Finding I've got bills stored away from like 2003 I've kept filed and going, where the fuck is this policy? Look, I've got a bill from 10 years ago I've kept because I'm meticulous. It must be here somewhere.
Did you get to the point where you actually started imagining that you actually seen it? So you know what
yes,
it looked like.
Yes. I'm sure it was a big book. Yes. Big book and in a plastic bag and I put it somewhere safe. But where is that safe place?
Yeah.
It's I was online. Nearly going out to hack down a rose bush and make a divining rod, I can tell you.
Cool. And anything else? Or is that the overriding epic?
That's the ongoing epic.
Okay.
Other than that, I did finally get round to seeing a film I've been looking forward to seeing. Then Ike and Mike did a podcast about it. It was spoilery. I thought, right, I'm buying the Blu-ray. And so it was the Soska Sisters' second feature, American Mary.
I've been recommended that, actually.
I really, really enjoyed it. I mean, it is, if you've seen Dead Hooker in a Trunk, for those who haven't seen it, it's cheap, it's nasty, it's stupid, it's dirty, grimy. It's a proper underground wild cartoon ride of exploitation.
Right.
American Mary, second feature, it is a quantum leap forward.
Hmm.
Beautifully shot, beautifully crafted. A real cinematic treat. I will say, without spoilers, some people have problems with the third act because things just kind of happen and there's no exposition. But yeah. To be honest, you should be able to fill in those gaps yourself. You know what I mean? It's kind of, it's very common. It's like it is such a cinematic treat. It's very like the Italian sort of total cinema idea.
Yeah.
Of kind of, you know, you it's about the mood, about the looks. You know, you should be able to put together what's happening in the narrative. No problem. Just go with the mood and the vibe of it. And, which I did. And I thoroughly enjoyed it. Very impressed. If that's done for their second feature, can't wait to see what they're going to do for the third.
Nice. And they're quite easy on the eye as well, those two, aren't they, as well? Which kind of helps.
It does help. I mean, they are proper nerds who just, fuck it, we'll make a film.
Nice.
And, you know, you know, it's kind of bloody hell. This is a, you know, a lot of filmmakers only have got one film in which they remake again and again and again. And see Dead Hooker, then see American Mary and just go, bloody hell, that's what you call progressing and in your craft, that is.
Nice. Oh, well, there you go. High praise indeed. We'll have to check that out. Cool. Well, moving on to Mr. Barnard. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing fine. this weekend, we started getting Laura used to walking long distances because she's going to be doing a 50k walk for charity. Mate.
50k?
50k walk.
What you mean? Right. You mean the sort of average size of a Word document, or are you talking
as in distance?
Distance, right?
Okay, 50 kilometers, right? Okay. Sorry. So we thought, she's like, well, okay, so let's try and, you know, see, you know, get me broken into walking distances. So we thought, right, we'll do five miles, right? Which is something like, I don't know, 8 kilometers or something like this.
Yeah.
So we walked all the way from our house to the O2, which is 5 miles.
Bloody hell.
Exactly. Yeah, right. Exactly. And I must admit, because we were walking quite slowly, my back fucking hell fire. We got into the cinema because we went to see Oblivion, and I'll tell you about that in a minute.
Okay.
But yeah, I ate so much. I didn't realise how much trouble I was in backwise until I bent down to look at the glass cabinet with all the sweets in it to try and choose which one I wanted. And as I got up, something went twang.
Yeah.
And it was like that. It almost paralysed me on the spot. It was almost like Crichton in Farscape when he does that pose for the statue. He goes, yeah, I'll be all cool. And then it's kind of like, ah! So, yeah, right. Almost did my back in there. But anyway, yes, so we went to see Oblivion.
I have to say, before you go any further, yeah, I have to say I love the dedication to the fitness regime, to getting ready for the 50K by going to the cinema and then looking straight into the sweets trolley.
That's me. That's me. Fine with it, you see. I've got no problem with walking 5 miles. Mind you, that's if I'm walking at my pace.
Five miles for a bag of Maltesers.
Yeah, 5 miles for a bag of Maltesers. There you go. I've just about worked that off. But there you go. But yeah. Oblivion.
Yeah, yes, yeah.
So, went to see it. Beautiful looking movie. Mm-hmm. Fantastic visual effects on it. And I must say, I actually quite enjoyed it.
Yeah?
You know, I thought it was a nice standard sci-fi romp. I can't quite see where all the hatred is coming from. Because I've heard one or two people didn't like it. I think they have anyway. Maybe it's just people making shit up. I don't know. But there seems to be a bit of negativity surrounding the actual film. And even though Laura has pointed out that it's like, well, it's borrowed a certain aspect of it from a certain movie, and I can't say because that would be spoiling it, I've got no problem with that because it's the whole, I mean, it's that, you know, there's nothing original really these days, and it's not so much if you copy something from a movie, it's what you do with that thing you've copied. You know, and I thought it all worked really well, you know. I thought it's like, yeah, that was fine. I felt entertained by that.
Cool. Did you like was it Tron Legacy, because the director of Tron Legacy did this?
I would no, this is the thing. I don't know where people are getting this idea nothing happens in it, because trust me, stuff happens in it.
No, it's not that nothing happens in it.
I've heard that somebody's that's been reported about it, and it's like, well, no, you must have been watching a different movie to the one I saw, because stuff goes on. You know, there is plenty of action in it. You know, you do get the big reveal about what's been going on, because, I mean, they fucking set that up in the trailer anyway.
Yeah.
And yeah, I thought it was all right. Yeah.
Cool. Cool. So, yeah. Thumbs up from you.
Yeah, thumbs up from me. I don't know if you'll like it. You see, because I say I like something, and then you go and say, well, this was bloody wrong with it. Ah, strangle.
I'll just be happy to get out of the fucking house, to be frankly.
You'll love it. I'm filled with Richard CBBCs. Yeah. It was a fantastic movie, best I've ever seen. On 51.
It's Ambrosia from the Gods. Show me it again.
Yes. Fucking Night Garden, shitting hellfire. But I say performances all round pretty good as well. Tom Cruise did his usual sort of hero thing. I mean, I've got no problem with the man sort of, you know, the whole acting thing. You know, ignoring his religious convictions with, you know, whatever it is he's into these days.
Don't mention it. Don't mention it, because of everything we could possibly get sued for, that would be the one that would actually happen.
Oh, I'm saying allegedly.
Let's not get into that.
These religious convictions. So yeah, thumbs up from me.
Cool.
Next week, I'm going to see Evil Dead.
What? Sorry?
Next week, I'm going to see Evil Dead.
Okay, cool. Well, I might be catching you up with some films in the cinema, because when Carol gets back, I am doing my damnedest to get the hell out of this house for a while, because I am going off my fucking rocker. I tell you what, I am starting to feel like Jack Torrance, except he had more fucking room and a maze. Seriously, I'm sitting in a
one kid to deal with.
Yeah, exactly. He only had one kid, and that kid took care of himself with a bike and everything. Anyway, my week has basically been decorating, playing with the kids, decorating, playing with the kids, decorate the kids, playing.
I noticed there's no, like, visit to A&E.
No, but that's because I actually self-medicated.
Oh, you did? Yeah. Right.
I got all the wallpaper off, a couple of weeks back with the steamer.
Yeah.
And what happened was, I'm like, okay, fine. And then my mum's like itching to get at the wallpaper, because my dad's obviously driving her mad. I think he's like waiting for an excuse to just try this pressure hose that he bought. Like a year back, and now he wants to try it out on everything. He's tried it out in the car. He's only been like one day where it's been like sunshine, and he's already tried it out in the car, tried it out on the stone steps, tried it out on the back garden, tried it out on the trees. He's blasting bits of bush away with this jet hose thing. Anyway, so Mum wanted to just get out of the house. So she's like, "Oh, when you're going to do your your wallpaper? Let me know, and I'll come and give you a hand." I'm like, oh, I could really use a hand, because last time I did it, I nearly fucking throttled myself with a lining paper. But so I thought, right, okay, fine. I said, is there anything you need me to do beforehand, apart from just taking the wallpaper off? She said, well, obviously you get little bits now and again, and they get stuck under the wallpaper, so you've got to make sure you scrape all that off. And I so last night and the night before, I'm sitting there, and I'm scraping away, and it's like taking all these little tiny pissy ant little bits, like, sort of the size of, the size of hen's teeth. I mean, it's really tiny little stuff, but I'm shitting myself that I'm going to fuck this wallpaper up. So I'm scraping all these little tiny bits off. Then a thought hits me. A thought that's going to speed this shit up, no problem.
Oh, dear. No. Any thought like that at this point, Lee, can only lead to disaster.
Well, it makes perfect sense. A bloody sander.
Oh, no. Oh,
so basically, I went and got the sander, and I put, like, the roughest grade of sandpaper on it, because they've got an electric sander. It's quite a meaty old thing. I sanded down a door in about 5 minutes, but it's quite heavy. Anyway, so I started. I've put this really rough grade of sandpaper on it. And it's like, it's like almost like sort of pebbles on it. I mean, it's that kind of rough. And
Christ.
I've put it on the wall, and I pressed the button, and it went, and it literally bounced like right out of my hand and dropped on my toe.
Ouch!
And I now have managed to take, I'm looking at it now. I've managed to take a quarter of my big toe off. Or quarter of my big toenail off.
So you were doing this naked again?
No. Just it's my foot, you fucking idiot.
Yeah, I know, but,
I wasn't doing it naked.
If you're holding a sander, mate, you've got to be wearing fucking foot protection at least.
No.
I'm in
my house.
Especially you. Look,
if you got a sander and you got a wall, the last thing you expected to do is head for your feet. It's like,
mate, this is you we're talking about.
Yeah, I know. But anyway, so it smashed down on my big toe. And if you're looking at my big toe and imagine it's kind of roughly square shape, obviously, then basically if you take the top left quarter, it's completely gone.
Good Lord.
Because basically where it landed on the edge and hit my toe. Luckily it didn't break it. But But yeah, but then all of a sudden, I just noticed that my toenail was kind of pointing at 90 degrees on one part of my nail. So yeah, so I kind of hobbled, bleeding profusely from my foot, into the kitchen. And then I spent like the next 2 hours after that, after wrapping it up and picking the nail off and all that kind of stuff, wrapping it up, and then I spent the next 2 hours cleaning blood out of the carpet, so that's good.
Superb.
I haven't quite managed to finish off the wallpaper yet. I haven't even really got it started. So there you go, but it's all to play for. Hopefully Mum will come around and save me, so that'll be good.
I think she needs to, mate, because, yeah. You know.
Yeah. But, you know, you don't expect a fucking sander to take your toenail off. I mean, really.
Dude.
God, it's plastic and a plate.
Handling any kind of equipment, right, that does DIY.
Mm.
I mean, if you want, I've got a pair of steel toe-cap boots you can borrow.
Well,
I have. Why aren't you wearing them, then?
Well, I was in my house. I didn't feel like I needed to. I felt safe. So my right foot, my big toe's kind of a bit swollen and kind of quarter nail-less. There you go.
You'll never do that again.
Well, no, because that part of the nail's gone. But other than that, what else have I done? Oh, I watched that sci-fi weekend thing on Film 4, which was very good. War of the Worlds, introduced the kids to War of the Worlds. That was really good. George Power version.
The George Power version. All right, okay, yeah.
Yeah, I have to say, I should have put this down for one of our films to watch. I have to say, because that alien, when you see it in the house, really don't hold up. not at all. It looks like someone bought a novelty penis from a Blackpool pier front and then put on a camera lens. But apart from that, no, we sat and watched that. Was it good? The kids loved that. And then I was kind of quite into this whole sci-fi sort of evening, so I went through it. You know, there was Nausicaa, Valley of the Wind, Planet of the Apes. There was something else I can't remember. Oh, Silent Running. Many tears were shed over the Huey, Dewey and Louie.
The kids or you?
Me.
You, I bet.
Yeah.
It's the little robot.
Look, he's still watering the plant even though his friend's dead.
A watering can and a bottle of baby bio and stuff. He's tiny.
Bruce Dern floating off into space and the last trees on Earth are going to... Oh, my God.
It's a robot.
It's a fucking robot. Anyway, so there was that. And then there was Beneath the Planet of the Apes, and then there was Alien. So that was good.
Very nice. So that excellent was
good,
stuff.
Good little combo. But then, right, the next night, kind of Channel 4 let themselves down a bit. Because I switched over and there was Mila Jovovich and what's it? Ultraviolet.
Oh,
have you seen it?
I've watched bits of it, right? And it's the. Do you know what? Sometimes if you're going to write a movie, you know, in English, it's best to get someone who can actually say English lines convincingly. And there's this one bit where. Mila Jovovich goes into this building and she's like surrounded by all these fucking troops.
Yep.
And this man stands there and in this, I'm not sure what his accent is, comes out with the line of, "Are you mental?" And it's like, what?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's your big line, is it?
Yeah. When you see the main villain has two tea strainers up his nose, that's kind of when you know that everything's kind of gone a bit awry. It's a bit like when you watch Phantom Menace and you realise that the false measurer is actually a hairband.
Yeah, well, it's no, actually,
it's a hairbrush, isn't it?
Oh, well, it's that, but you know the actual radio that Qui-Gon Jinn uses to talk back to the ship.
Yeah.
Is actually a lady shave. It's a Gillette. It's a was it Gillette Venus? I think it is.
Yeah, it's, well, like, it's the same sort of thing.
Fucking
the,
razor.
The main villain. The main villain has these two tea strainers up his nose. It's, and once you see it, you can't unsee it. And it's like, that's a fucking tea strainer. He's not a science fiction bad guy. He's got a fucking tea strainer on his face.
I'll have a cup if you make him one.
Exactly. And but no, I watched it. I actually watched it. I thought, it gets a bad rap, and I've seen bits of it, but I'm going to watch it all the way through. And you know what?
What?
It's fucking rubbish.
Yeah,
it is a colossal turd. I mean, I genuinely couldn't believe how shit it was. And it actually became my obsession for like a day of trying to find out all about it and find out about how shit and how it actually happened. And it turned out it was just a monstrous clusterfuck from the start to the finish. Half the bloody script was written and then cut out before it was even filmed. And then the editing was done by a monkey or something. They had some trained baboon. And the special effects were done on a budget of like 15p. And there was this, it's just awful. Awful. And even all the actors, even Hoba, they all denounced it. They all walked off the set. They didn't turn up for the premiere. It was that fucking bad. Yeah. They wouldn't even put their faces to it. Even off. But it's terrible. It's a terrible, terrible film. And the worst bit is, it's like one of those films that's so monumentally bad that you just sit there with your mouth open and you think, why? How could they make this boring? It's like imagine cyberpunk, triads, vampires, and big corporations all clashing over a child who may or may not be carrying a virus that it once unleashed will either spell the end of one of the factions.
Right.
And this woman, the Hoover, she basically kidnaps him. But the thing is, it's like the special effects are all supposed to seem like really cool and science fiction, but they actually look like shit. Because there's one bit where she gets this box. She's a courier, and she's get told, you've got to get this weapon. Don't open the box. Don't look in the box. And she picks it up, and she gets this thing. She sneaks out. She kills 100 people on the way. And this thing, right, no joking, is probably about the size of a 15-inch laptop. It's white.
Yeah.
And it's like about 2 inches thick. And she's in the lift, this lift, trying to escape this building. And she actually decides to open this box. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And she opens the box. And you look inside, and it's like a pond. And in the pond is the kid. You just see the head of the kid. It's like...
What?
Did no one actually understand the dimensions of this thing, or did they just... I mean, it looked like, to me, it looked like what happened was the shot had been given to an effects person, and it said, the child has to be in this box. So the guy's obviously just worked it out and gone, right, okay, well, the box must be, like, 6 feet deep, because the shot is from the top down. But what you don't realise is this thing is like a fucking laptop, and yet when they open it up, it looks like something from fucking Minority Report, you know, with them lying in a big pool of weird spunky fluid, and it's just like.
So he has a child the size of a garden gnome.
No, the child is fully sized, full sized child
inside a box the size of
a laptop.
A laptop.
Yeah.
This is fucking with my head.
Exactly. And it's like, the worst thing is, it doesn't even look convincing at all. It looks like some outtake from Nightmare.
Christ.
It really does.
Nasty.
Yeah. I kept expecting her to walk around with a bucket on her head. I mean, because it's like, it does. She's holding this thing still, and the fucking pond with the kid in it is kind of, you can't keep still for a second. And I, once I saw that, I thought, oh, I've got to watch this right through to the end. And all the bike stunts and all these kind of things are done on this really shonky blue screen where the camera's moving, but the background clearly isn't.
Oh dear.
So, you know, it's like, no. This looks like one of those fan films, you know, the Star Trek fan films that you see when you see one of the actors from the series who's clearly down on his luck, and some kid with a fucking shed recreation of the Bridge of the Enterprise decides to make an entire film and put it on YouTube. Yeah. It looks like that.
Oh dear.
So we will be covering it in the very near future.
Sounds like a real treat.
It's a right fucking romp, I tell you.
I think it's on that list I gave you anyway, so.
He's spectacular. And they managed to actually make Mila Jovovich walking naked in a room full of UV light as about as unsexy as anything. I mean, it's just like, oh.
Really?
Yeah. There's one bit where she's stark bollock naked walking down a corridor, and you just think, this looks like an advert for Chanel or something. It's just bad, done.
Full frontal jobby?
No, you don't get to see Squirrel Girl.
No curly top streaks or anything like that. No,
you don't get to see Tufty Club. No, Tufty the Squirrel is not coming out to play. So anyway, there you go. So I've lost a nail, I've lost my mind, I dropped a sander on my foot, and I watched a really, really shit film about vampires, which actually doesn't have anyone being a vampire in it at all at any point in time. That's even worse. It's just like, ugh, rubbish. So there you go. That's my depressing life. but there you go. But we are we have got Carol coming home from Africa, which is going to be good, on Sunday. And then she said, oh, I know. She gave me a call. She said, can you pick me up from the train station? And I was like, okay, rather than the airport, because you know, she's landing. She's getting out of the airport at like 6 in the morning.
Okay.
So I said, okay, fine. When is it again? Oh, it's Sunday. Right, okay, fine. Where is the train station? Paddington. Okay, right, fine. In London. Yeah, okay, fine. Yeah, I know where Paddington is. Hold on. Sunday, that's the London fucking marathon. Oh, okay. So, yes. So now, rethinking the plans, I'm now having to get the kids up, dressed, and into the car at 4 in the morning so that we can drive to Heathrow.
I was going to say, yeah, you better avoid the marathon anyway because of the unfortunate events that happened 2 days ago.
Yeah.
Apparently the security is being overhauled in London for the marathon. So, yeah.
You mean yesterday? Don't say 2 days ago, otherwise we'll become suspects.
Oh, will we?
Yeah.
Well, it will be 2 days ago by the time this goes out.
Because we record it on Tuesday.
Yep.
And it goes out on Wednesday. You say 2 days ago. I mean, it sounds like anyway, you knew it was happening before it happened. Never mind.
But no, it is 2 days. Well, anyway, but yeah, you it's wise that you get out at 4 o'clock and get to Heathrow.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah, I think so. But yes. So think of me on Sunday morning at 4 o'clock in the morning, trying to get a 5-year-old and an 8-year-old awake and in the car.
The only way I'm going to be thinking...
Go the day before, book into a Premier Inn and play Find Lenny Henry all night.
Yes, there you go.
Or the guy who plays Hazel. What's his fucking name?
That's not Hazel.
Shelley, Howell Bennett, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, God, I can never remember, but I know he was in Red Dwarf a while back, wasn't he, as that killer robot.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, he's probably dead now. He's probably run out of food. On that bleak note, shall we have some news?
Yes, let's do it. Hey, we're gonna hear some news now.
Okie dokie. Right, well, Iron Man 3 news now. Well, actually, it's just Iron Man news now. Apparently, after a number of on-set injuries and a desire to get more deeply into filmmaking, Robert Downey Jr. has announced that he's very, 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 very likely to hang up his Iron Man suit, probably after Iron Man 3, but more than likely after the Avengers 2. So he's done it before. He's done this kind of announcement that he's not going to be doing Iron Man anymore, usually seen as a negotiation tactic. But looks like he's serious. So what do you think?
I think he'd be a fucking idiot if he went out before Avengers 2. I'll tell you that now.
Really? Because, I mean, if it sounds like he's getting injured a lot.
No, this is the thing. He's dithering between going after Iron Man 3 or after Avengers 2. But if he's got any sense, he'll hang on to after Avengers 2, take his fucking paycheck and then walk.
Mm.
Because, I mean, the first one made a shit ton of money, and this next one is going to do the same, whether it's shit or not.
Mm.
Doesn't matter. It's going to make a shit ton of cash.
Yeah. But then,
plus, what injuries is he actually getting? Someone like Robert Downey Jr. is insured up the wazoo to the point they won't let him cross a street in case it's dangerous.
Yeah, exactly.
So maybe, you know, he bent his Coke spoon or something. I don't buy it.
Well, I mean, it's not like
he's got an eye on a nice new conservatory made of crack cocaine. That's all it is.
Well, it's not like he actually has to wear the armour at all, does it? I mean, it's all CG anyway. But yeah, now there's sort of rumours, obviously spurring off of that, saying that, you know, the fact that there's so many Iron Man suits in the universe of Marvel now, what with the Don Gold Blimey Governor Cheadle, and there will be another person donning an Iron Man suit in number 3. I won't spoil it, but I do know who it is.
Well, there's going to be a second one donning it in number 2. In number 3. Yeah, he's number 3, isn't it? Sorry, my apologies. Yeah, I know who that person is.
Wake up, Granddad.
Hello.
Hello. Do you want your biscuits?
Hello. Yes, thank you. Is it time for bed?
Yeah, feels like it. I don't even know what day it is. I only knew it was Tuesday by the fact someone sent me a text message. Anyway, so yeah, so we all think he's just aiming for more cash then. Is that what we're thinking?
I even now doubt he even said it at all, and it's just one of these bits of bollocks they pump out in the name of news, just to keep the buzz going.
Yeah, I suppose so.
I think so. I just look at it this way. I mean, this is the biggest role he's ever had. For sake of nothing else, it's the biggest role he's ever had.
Yeah,
it's true. Really. It's, you know, he's getting on now.
Hmm.
You know, he's in his 50s now.
Yep.
You know, it's really hard for maybe an actor of that age to come by a gig like this.
Oh, I don't know. Old Sean did quite well, didn't he?
Yeah, but well, that's Sean Connery. That's like James Bond, you know.
But go on, in fantasy casting, while we're thinking about it, who would you have if he did leave, if he did stop being Tony Stark? Who would you have as Tony Stark?
Limey.
Joe Pasquale.
Hello, I'm Iron Man.
Bobby Ball. Then he could be Iron Ball. Oh. Rock on, Sobby. Time to rock. Hey.
I don't know. Fassbender. Get him in there.
Fassbender
in there. Fuck it. I know he's Magneto in X-Men, but they've not even bought. Like, they're not even part of that franchise. So fuck it, Fassbender. If in doubt, Fassbender.
Mm.
In fact, they should have a glass case. They should clone Michael Fassbender and put him in a break-in case of emergency case, just in case the main actors of any film that they're doing suffer like a mishap, like get a run over by a fucking donut truck or something. You know. Break the glass, out comes Fassbender, straight in there. He can take the role.
High School Musical replacement, yep, Fassbender.
Yep, Fassbender, yep. Different Strokes, Arnold, Fassbender. Now the world don't move to the beat of just one drum. So, yeah, Fassbender.
Right. Okay. What about you, Jim? Who would you have apart from Joe Pasquale?
Oh, I don't know. There's probably loads of people look good in a goatee.
Oh, Jim, you smooth talking bastard! You, of course, I'll accept the role. so nice of you to bring it up. Sorry,
who would you like to see take a?
Who,
like,
me?
Yeah.
Look, a monkey.
Liam Neeson.
yeah, that's it.
The thing you don't understand is...
yeah, these iron machines are killing machines. And if we're within 150 yards of their cubs, we're already dead.
I have a particular set of outfits.
Yeah. Now, you need to have someone sassy, kind of smart-ass. I don't know, just don't make it Ricky Gervais. I think that's the only thing I can possibly come up with.
God's sake, don't make it Ricky Gervais.
But now I've said it, it's got to happen. You know what it'd probably end up being? It'd probably end up being Johnny Depp.
There you go. I was just thinking that, actually. Jesus Christ almighty, am I broadcasting that wide?
Yes, exactly. You are. Oh, dear. Oh, yeah. Speaking of... No, it's all right, we'll talk about that later. I'm just going to go off on a massive tangent there. Next piece of news.
Should we talk about everybody's favourite car movie?
Mm.
There's the other bit of news. Fast and the Furious 6 hasn't even touched down at the cinemas yet. And number 7 has already been mooted for less than a year after 6 comes out.
You know what? I give that a fuck you out of 8.
Yeah, I bet you do.
I really...
We're not getting a Judge Dredd sequel yet. We've got 7 fucking Fast and Furious movies. What is wrong with this fucking world?
Though, in fairness, isn't this based on something Vin Diesel said?
What, like, now, one, to another movie?
Well, can he count... This is what we need to know.
Up to 7? Yes. Yes.
Well, I don't know. I'm a little dubious.
I'm clutching at straws here. But, you know, it could be some, you know, I couldn't get his socks off to count up to the right number in time. And
Oh dear! Right, okay. There was the other changing the subject before he comes around and beats me up. Yeah, the next piece of news is there's been some pictures of Electro for the new Spider-Man movie.
Yep,
showing up, which appears to have the blue milk from which last featured in Star Wars: A New Hope being thrown all over Jamie Foxx. that's it.
Spider-Man 2, blue Bukkake.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Smurf Bukkake. That's what you need. He looks like he's been in a Smurf jizz fest.
Do you know what? I know sort of like the general joke is when we talk about sequels to movies and somebody does say Electric Boogaloo, right? I mean this is quite a coincidence that this is a sequel to the first one and they've got a bloke in it called Electro. Right. Who is probably a dancer or something like that. So, there you go.
Yes. Spider-Man 2, Electro Boogaloo. Yes. I was going to say, the other thing I was going to say about him is, it's quite funny that all the pictures that were released of Jamie Foxx wandering around in that thing, he's got this luminous hoodie with lights all on the inside, glowing blue on his big blue face. And it's like, not trying to draw attention to yourself then.
No, of course not.
Move silently through the crowds.
Yes. Fucking lit up face.
I'm covered in crackling electricity. Best put me hood up. that'll sort it.
No one will find me in here. My cunning disguise. From the yellow hello book of disguises.
Yeah.
It is I, Leclerc. Electro. So anyone got any other opinions on that, or are we moving on?
Well, Electro, I mean, is he... wouldn't be my first choice for a villain for a Spider-Man movie. But I get the impression, yeah, thinking, oh, Christ, we've done them. Done all more. No.
Yeah. I must... Mm. Yeah. I mean, to be quite honest, Electro is probably better than the Rhino, because at least Electro has powers, whereas the Rhino just looks like a big fat knob in a suit.
Oh, the Vulture. I am a flying slaphead.
Yeah. Patrick Stewart to the stage. Patrick Stewart to the stage.
We've got to see what this version of the Rhino looks like, because of Paul Giamatti is supposed to be playing him. What a total left field bit of casting for the fucking, you know, for it's like, I don't know, having
Joe Pasquale playing Iron Man.
Yeah, exactly. Joe Pasquale playing Iron Man.
Maybe you've called it, Jim. Maybe that's it. And there are some of the guitar nerves. I am Iron Man. Fucking hell.
Welcome to summer season at Blackpool.
Said Papa Smurf.
Iron Man coming to you live from the from the Working Men's Club of Brillington. Anyway, then there was the General Zod can't tune his TV in viral.
Yes. I must say, my reaction whilst that is, if that is the height of Kryptonian technology, we don't have anything to fear. And
I just had a vision of him trying to do this whole thing, do this message to Earth, and holding up a sort of 1950s style V aerial, trying to just sort of hold it at one arm while he's
Ursa, fiddle with the tracking some more.
Yeah. Put your leg up. Lean out. Earth, I will come and get you. Oh, fuck, I've stubbed my toe. Oh, they lost the picture again. So no one was impressed by the viral then?
No. I was more impressed by the pictures that I saw today.
Oh, yes.
Actually, mm-hmm. Some promo shots, some new ones, and I've got to say, the suit's looking pretty good in the promo shots. It's still very dark, but I think it's the lighting, because he's outside and he's doing all the pose and everything like this, and he does look the part, I've got to say, you know. And there's a picture of General Zod kind of fucking losing it, literally, in that sort of, you know, giving it the whole, I'm going to rip your fucking kneecaps off type of look. And considering the actor who's playing him, yeah, I'm not surprised.
No.
You know, because he has played some pretty sort of evil roles in his time. So,
yes.
So, yeah. So, looking good so far, I think.
Cool.
But we'll see.
Yeah.
Of course.
Okie dokie. Any other bits of news before we move on?
Yep, certainly is. Of course, we've had the new final Star Trek trailer today.
Right.
And I have to say to people, if you don't want to be spoiled for a couple of things that are going to appear in the movie, which I think, really, let's wait and see them. I wish I hadn't watched it today. I'd say steer clear of the final trailer. If you're not bothered about spoilers, then go ahead and watch it. But for most of it, 90% of it, is fine, but really just 2 points in the trailer kind of give a couple of things away. And it's pretty disappointing considering, I mean, look at what they reveal. It's like, well, they were holding back a bit on the trailers beforehand.
Really?
You know, you basically got the same recycled stuff but cut differently in the other trailers, and this bit reveals more. Yeah.
I was going to say, because the poster came out the other day and it was just basically the Enterprise on fire falling to Earth.
I kind of understand how that happens now from watching the trailer. I've kind of put two and two together where that's concerned.
Okay.
Like, oh, okay.
Okay. Fair enough. So does that mean JJ's going to piss off even more Trekkies by bringing in the Enterprise D or something? It's just for the next generation or something.
I'm not telling you what it is that goes on in there. As I say, you know. So okay. If you want to go watch it.
I have to say, I've been so distracted with medical emergencies and wallpaper, I've not actually seen anything on the internet this week. I'll be honest with you.
Then good, steer clear.
Okie dokie.
But moving on from that, apparently Zombieland, the TV series, is premiering its first episode on the Amazon streaming service, and it's completely free.
Really?
It's going to be available for a whole month.
What?
So
for free,
yeah. The first episode of the TV show.
But I've not heard of the Amazon streaming service. Do you have to sign up for that, or?
I'm not quite sure. I've just seen the actual article about it. So, yeah, apparently it's going to be available for a month. Oh. So I'm not quite sure what their streaming service is called. I'm sure it's pretty much like Love Film.
Yeah, it is. Amazon Instant Video and Love Film UK.
No. Yeah.
Mm. Cool. So
who knows? Maybe it will come onto Love Film as well.
Nice.
I mean, you can always do the 30-day trial with that then, so, you know, you're not exactly signing up for anything.
Hmm. But then again, I wasn't that taken with Zombieland, I'll be honest with you. I thought bits of it were good, and I enjoyed certain cameos and certain, you know, rules and regs and all that kind of stuff with the zombies. Yeah. But the Emma Stone moment right at the end when they all get on, when she suddenly decides to go to a fun fair, start it up, and is surprised when the zombies jump her because the fucking lights are seen from miles around. It's like, right, okay. Yeah.
You kind of asked for that one, didn't you?
Yeah, exactly. Mm. It seemed like it was manufacturing an ending where it didn't really have one. Cool. So there you go.
Yes. Well, there is only two more bits. Very good bits. We had the release of the Old Boy poster, the Spike Lee one.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of people look at that and they think it looks like somebody marking off the days on a wall. Actually, I don't think that is that at all. I think he's actually been listening to this podcast, Lee.
Really?
Why? Because those look like possibly the scratches on your body that, you know, you had after scrubbing yourself in the shower after watching the original with the Brillo pads or the wire brush. So there you are. It's a warning to us all.
Yeah, that was the unclean. It's like I hugged myself in the shower and rocked backwards and forwards. Yeah, that's pretty much it. That's exactly what the story's about. It's Old Boy. The Old Boy remake isn't actually a remake. It's a person watching Old Boy.
That is it. Yes, that's the reaction you get. And the final piece of news. Uh-huh. Like, the next Expendables movie that they're going to make, right?
At first,
it's like a fucking home for aging actors, right? But I think now what it's going to do is it's going to start harboring sort of like actors that have fallen out of favour because they've done something wrong and ended up in prison or in a certain sect or a race of people, because not only do they have Wesley Snipes joining them, right, who's just come out of prison, but they're also looking at getting Mel Gibson in there as well.
What about Danny Glover for the win?
Let's have a look, shall we? No, at the moment they're talking about Wesley Snipes has officially joined the cast.
Oh, whoopee, I'll be first in line for that.
They're now courting Mel Gibson to actually head up to helm it. Let's see, does that actually mean
as a helmet?
Yeah, I was going to say as a helmet, in something he wears on his head.
They're going to get Mel Gibson to direct it. So this is a bit like the modern day Diagnosis Fucking Murder, right, with Dick Van Dyke. Because if you've ever watched that program, you'll know that Dick Van Dyke, all he does, he just employs his relatives in that show.
Yeah.
That's it. Every week there's a bad guy, it's another relative of his, like a sister of his wife or something like that. So this is basically what it's turned into. It is the modern-day equivalent of Diagnosis Murder.
But I don't understand why.
I'm expecting Van Dyke to show up in it at some point.
Oh God! What about Tom Selleck? Has Tom Selleck got a role?
No, Tom Selleck's
he's too classy. He'd be Hulk Hogan next.
But yeah, fucking right, it will be
the Undertaker.
What I want to know is where's Dutkoff? You know, where's Rothrock?
See if you're Rothrock.
Where's Don the Dragon Wilson? You know,
where's Mark Duplass?
Peter Purvis.
It'll fuck him up. You watch.
Michael Burke.
Yes, Michael Burke. Get him in there. This just in your face.
Frank Boff.
Ross, so we need a British version of the Expendables. We need to get people like that in there. Frank Boff, Jan Leeming,
Dick Henry.
Dick Henry, he's dead. I mean, that'll be animatronic by Jerry. Oh, no, even Jerry Anderson.
Can't even do Jerry Anderson. No. Yeah.
So yeah, you know, maybe chuck Jim Davison in there or in a pit. Actually, no, yeah.
Colin Baker,
John Nettles.
McCoy.
Oh God. Okay. Put that on the Facebook.
Putting them in there.
Yeah, that's it. Put that on the Facebook group. There's a challenge to the Facebook group if you're listening on facebook.com/group/theblackdogpodcast. Come up with your own UK Expendables. There you go.
Excellent.
That'll keep people busy. I'm sure there'll be some great entries from that.
I can already hear Chris actually reaching for the graphics tablet as we speak.
Esther Ranson.
The
team of That's Life coming back, including who's Richard Stilgo.
Well, Richard Stilgo is busy now being Tim Minchin.
Johns. Let's dig him up and get him in there as well. You know? Fucking hellfire. Dennis Waterman. Don't forget Dennis Waterman.
Don't forget, yeah. John.
You've saved on the theme tune then as well. Yeah. You know? Get a two for one.
It could be so good for you. Danny Dyer. Yeah, because you've got to have at least one person who's the young one who gets killed off.
Straight away.
Yeah. There you go. So there you go. There's some ideas. Go ahead and line up your UK Expendables.
And then fire. No.
Yeah. Who was the guy who played Sergeant Bob Cryer in The Bill?
I can't remember his name.
Had a face like a whippet in a rat in a wind tunnel.
Burnside, the one who played Burnside, you want him there as well.
That was Christopher Ellison.
Oh God! Everyone outside of like the 1970s or the UK doesn't have a fucking clue what we've just been talking about for the last 40 minutes.
There we go. Nope.
They've all clicked away and looking at naughty drawings of Elastigirl probably by now.
Oh, Elastigirl, you must be tamed. Oh, sorry, getting a little
Dickie
ahead of
fucking it. Davis. That's what you wanted there as well.
Dickie Davis. Michael Dickie Fish.
World of Sport. I've got your World of Sport right here, Davis.
And, yeah, Michael Fish, the weather forecast is for pain.
Yes. He could be the forecaster.
Oh, God. And in front of it all, leading the charge, Michael Parkinson. Michael Parkinson's Expendables.
Looking at you.
And you get a free Parker pen right up the ass.
It could be like, he is the British equivalent of Chuck Norris. Michael Parkinson.
Parkies Expendables. No salesperson will call, but we'll fuck you up. No one knows what we're talking about anymore.
No.
Bye bye, listeners. Anyway, oh dear. Oh, Jim.
Yes.
Do you have a profanosauri for us?
I do indeed.
Okay. Oh, pray silence for Jim Moon's Profanosaurus.
Psst! Andy's coming. Code phrase. If while visiting one of Disney's famous theme parks and tourist traps, shouting this phrase in earshot of the poor Wazzaks sweating their jugwoods off it, dressed up as characters from Toy Story, will make them suddenly stop whatever they are doing, freeze, and fall down flat, deflated on the floor. Much like when the door unexpectedly opens on a gentleman indulging in some Pixar handimation.
Thank you very much for that, sir.
Go clap.
Oh, dear. Oh, well, there you go. So, that's that. Shall we move on? Have you got anything, Darren?
No.
No.
Nothing.
Nothing.
You've got nothing.
You have nothing, Zabowski. Right.
Nope.
Oh, right, cool. I've skipped past that then. Right. A win for me. Right, well, I guess we better move on to Rose Tinted Specs for this week's movie, which is The Expendables. No, it's fucking not. It's not The Expendables at all. It's The Incredibles. What the fuck?
Rose Tinted Specs. Rose Tinted Specs.
You're gonna watch a film you like when you were young, sticking in the player, then send feedback when it's done. Has it stood the test of time, a classic evermore? Or has the movie lost the charm, a cinematic gore? We'll read out your thoughts on this week's Rose Tinted Specs. We'll read out your thoughts on this week's Rose Tinted Specs.
Oh my God, call an ambulance! Ah, so The Expendables, released in 2010. Went for a budget of $80 million, recovered $274 million, starring Sylvester Stallone.
Joe Pasquale. Frank Joe. Pop.
Clive Dunn.
Clive Dunn. Half a mullet. And Kenny Everett. No, sorry. Oh dear, sorry, just making ourselves laugh now, isn't it? Right. The Incredibles, directed by Brad Bird, written by Brad Bird, and star sorry Columbo.
Alan Moore. I wrote the script. The first draft.
Yeah, the original draft. Yeah, Alan Moore. And, yeah, Grant Morrison. Anyway, starring Craig T. Nielsen, Holly Hunter, Sarah Val, Spencer Fox, Jason Lee, Samuel Jackson, Elizabeth Pena, and Brad Bird. Music by Michael Giacchino. Released by Pixar. It was released November the 5th, 2004 in the States and October 27th, 2004 in the UK. The film had a budget of $92 million and was, until Toy Story 3, Pixar's biggest success, with a box office of $631 million.
Wow.
Not a bad return, I think you'll agree.
Fairly change that, isn't it?
Yeah, The Incredibles was originally concepted back by Brad Bird back in 1993 when he was trying to break into film. He had personal issues and, generally speaking, was trying to work out how to balance his burdening, sort of burgeoning film career and with his family, with his new family life, and was trying to work out what was, you know, what was more important to him, you know, whether or not it was, you know, to be famous and creatively interested or stimulated, or to be a family man. And that's where the nugget for The Incredibles was first born. During that time, he was already working on The Iron Giant, which was his first film for Warner Brothers. Excuse me, cup of tea. And basically, he was always kind of coming back to the idea of doing a comic book and a comic book movie. The problem was, obviously, was that he didn't have any license to anything. And also, The Iron Giant tanked at the cinema. So he's, you know, his cachet of... you know, sort of directorial cachet sort of went down the toilet with it. However, he did carry on with the concept and finally hooked up with Pixar after Iron Giant had basically been sealed as a complete failure. And he went over to see his friend John Lasseter at Pixar. And then it was while he was sort of drowning his sorrows that he basically slung the idea at Lasseter and asked whether or not, you know, Pixar would be interested in doing it. That obviously the rest is history on that front. That was in 2000. And Brad Bird and Lasseter knew each other from their college years in the 1970s. Lasseter was sold on the idea and convinced Brad Bird to come to Pixar, where the film would be done in CG. The studio announced a multi-film contract with Bird in 2000, and this broke Pixar's mold of having directors who had risen through the animation ranks. Brad Bird was the first external director. Yeah, this was also be the first film where all the characters were human. The first Pixar film with all human characters. So there you go. And yes, Bird came to Pixar with a lineup of the stories. The story family members worked out: a mum and a dad both suffering through dad's midlife crisis, shy teenage girl, cocky 10-year-old boy, and a baby. Brad Bird had based their powers on family archetypes. After several failed attempts to cast Edna Mode, Bird took it on the voice role himself. And it was an extension of Pixar's custom of taping in-house staff whose voices came across particularly well on Scratch dialogue tracks. That's about it. Moving on, Bird brought on a lot of the Iron Giant animators who were all 2D traditional animation guys, and they all had to learn in a hurry 3D, but that kind of went really rather well. He found computer animation difficult in a different way than working traditionally, finding the software sophisticated and not particularly friendly. Brad Bird wrote the script without knowing any limitations or concerns that went hand in hand with the medium of computer animation. As a result, this was the most complex film for Pixar yet. The film's characters were designed by a guy called Tony Fasile and Teddy Newton, both of whom Brad Bird brought with him from The Iron Giant. Like most CG films, The Incredibles had a year-long period of building the film from the inside out, modelling exteriors, understanding controls that work face and body, articulation of characters, rigging, and so on, before the animation could even begin. There's lots of stuff about the Pixar history. One thing that... Brad Bird would later confess was that he doesn't actually read an awful lot of comic books. They're not really his thing. In fact, the only comic book he was even remotely aware of was Watchmen. It was the only real comic he was ever sort of aware of, and even then he hadn't really read it, as I understand. Though when he was told that Incredibles obviously clearly took some influence from it or was comparable to it. He took that as a compliment. The one thing that always annoyed him with comic books as a trope was that the evil villains were always, to quote, comic booky, insofar as they would be evil, but they would never be so evil as to, I don't know, kill a kid or, you know, attack families or all that sort of thing. They would always pull back. They'd always just go for the hero. They'd never do anything, you know, sort of personal to children or anything like that. And the one thing that Bird wanted to do was actually make the villain of Syndrome and all the henchmen genuinely threatening, which was kind of one extra little addition. The other thing that influenced the Incredibles, apart from Brad Bird's own personal experiences and his own need to draw a comic book, was the early 60s movies, James Bond movies. So much so that he tried to get John Barry on to do the soundtrack. And then he later brought on Michael Giacchino when John Barry refused, because he said after seeing the trailer, which used On Her Majesty's Secret Service as a trailer track, said he wouldn't want to redo one of his own scores again. So Barry refused, Giacchino came on and basically reworked On Her Majesty's Secret Service for the Incredibles soundtrack. The Incredibles earned an absolute shit ton of universal acclaim. It's got a Metacritic review of 90 out of 100. Roger Ebert said of the film, it alternates breakneck action with satire of suburban sitcom life, and another example of Pixar's mastery of popular animation. Rolling Stone lauded the film with saying it's one of the year's best. It doesn't ring cartoonish, it rings true. People magazine found Incredibles boasted a strong and entertaining story and truckload of savvy comic touches. There was a couple of controversial reviews where National Review Online named The Incredibles number 2 on its list of 25 best right-wing conservative movies of all time, saying that it celebrates marriage, courage, responsibility and high achievement, and there is no failure. And basically Brad Bird was approached about it being a right-wing propaganda film, to which he just said that was fucking ridiculous, or words to that effect, and just dismissed it. I will probably leave it there. Like I say, it's the most successful Pixar movie since that was only topped by Toy Story 3. And there you go. It spawned comics and video games. There was rumours of a sequel in 2004 when Disney just owned the sole rights. But then when Disney acquired Pixar, or rather the other way around, but we never really talk about that, it suddenly stopped, with Brad Bird vetoing the whole thing, saying that he would only do a sequel if there was a story that would exceed the original. And that's that. So, let's get some opinions. Jim, what did you think of The Incredibles?
Well, I've not seen this movie in quite a few years. Mm-hmm. I loved it when it first came out. Mm-hmm. And I pretty much loved it again this time round.
Mm.
I mean, it did strike me as kind of, this does draw a lot from Watchmen. Mm. But you know, it's kind of, well, I think that's more of a problem for Watchmen than anything else. Because I think, you know, you can't hold it against The Incredibles, because it is a very similar story, but it's different enough. Hmm. But at the same time, it's a bit of a niggle at the back of my mind that what I will dub the John Carter effect that Mr. Barnard has alluded to before, that you all get people who read Watchmen going, this is just The Incredibles.
Oh, yeah.
And get it the wrong way around. But said, that isn't the film's fault, and that's me being a niggly twat.
You're all niggly twats, so welcome here.
Well, going on, I mean, I'll just take the broad swathes of praise as read. Mm-hmm. because I mean, it still looks really good. Mm. I mean, it is probably one of the most cinematic of these new breed of computer animated films.
Yeah,
and it still looks, well, incredible. however, I do think there's a couple of things that did bug me this time around. Not enough to ruin the film, but mm-hmm. worth airing, I think. Mm-hmm. One is the two kids are largely redundant.
Yeah.
They don't really need to be there. Mm. In a, 'cause it is Mr. Incredible and Elastic Girl's story, really.
Yeah.
And to be honest, I think that's a good thing, actually.
Mm.
'Cause I can, you know, with this kind of film, traditional Hollywood would be pushing for the focus to be on the kids because the kids have to have kids to relate to.
Yeah.
Whereas by taking the path he did, I think it's a stronger film for it. It's got deeper themes.
Hmm.
But I did find mostly Dash was just irritating.
Yeah.
Just kind of, oh, you little twat, shut up, sit down, be quiet for 10 minutes. But the other thing that bugged me, and it's something, I think this is being sort of more compounded by films that have come after it, is that with all the characters, they all look sort of fairly normal. They're not kind of like the freakish shapes you get in other computer animated films because no one can just fucking draw a human. They have to make them a weird, wacky shape. Mm. And two things leapt out where The Incredibles kind of just tipped over the edge. It's kind of all the women are far too thin. Mirage makes pipe cleaners look obese. I mean, it did sort of kind of, it wouldn't have killed them to give her a more realistic figure.
Hmm.
And I know you said it was what Tony Facile and Ted Nugent, whoever did the character designs, but I was wondering if it wasn't, what's the twat's name? Completely forgotten his name. Comic book artist, Rob Liefeld.
Oh,
because
God.
Clearly no one could draw a foot. All the characters taper down to these tiny little points.
But the only thing, really, reason it couldn't be Rob Liefeld is the feet weren't hidden behind rocks, conveniently placed.
They weren't covered in pouches either, in the costumes.
And Elastigirl's spine didn't go in the wrong direction when she was just standing in a natural pose. Yeah.
But yeah, that just kind of, I know there's the whole uncanny valley thing that, and I think, well, it wouldn't have killed you to give them proper feet.
Yeah.
but other than that, brilliant film.
I was going to say, it comes to something when the criticism is they could have had better feet. welcome to the chiropodists podcast. This week, corns and superheroes. cool. Well, thank you for that, Jim. So, Darren, what about you? What did you think of The Incredibles?
This, for me, is a film that never gets old.
Mm.
I can watch it and watch it and watch it, and I never get fed up with it.
Mm.
I really love this film. I think we said it last week about this possibly being one of the best superhero movies ever made.
Mm.
I think that's absolutely true. I also think it's a pretty damn good secret agent movie as well.
Yeah.
And I was thinking about this last night, actually, and two superhero movies that I really enjoy have both got that same element in it. And it's one of them is this one, and the other one is X-Men First Class.
Mm.
That's very much in the same sort of vein.
Yeah.
There's a whole sort of secret agent element to that. And I'm just wondering if maybe some of the best, you know, the way to do a superhero movie is to have that in there.
Well, maybe what both X-Men First Class and The Incredibles share is the fact that they create a world where this stuff is just normal.
Yeah, maybe that's it.
So when you stick a sort of spy story on it just to give it a bit of extra sort of twang, it's just sauce for the goose, as I think, you know, it's just kind of like that nice little extra bit on top.
Yeah.
And it doesn't stand out quite so much. But anyway, that, I mean, that's just me. But anyway, carry on. Go on, sorry.
I love the humour in this. I think some of the best stuff in this film takes place in just out of the corner of your eye. Mm. You know, there's stuff that goes on in the background that's just great. It's like, just take for example, there's a bit where they're all at the dinner table and Elastigirl is sitting there talking to her husband. And she's got a fork with a, what looks like a potato or something on the end of it. And you just see Jack-Jack just reaching for it with his mouth open, just trying to eat the potato. And I love the little things like that in it.
Yeah.
Those little things that go on in the background. That's what, I mean, it's the same sort of thing with a lot of Pixar movies. They put these wonderful, you know, there's always something going on.
Nice observational humour.
Exactly. And if you don't get it the first time, you'll notice it maybe like two or three viewings in. You know, and it's, oh, I didn't spot that before.
Yeah.
So there's that. Again, when it comes to one of my favourite bits in it, it's a very, very small thing. It's when Dash is running away from the Buzzcrafts, you know, the ones with the blades around them. And he's getting near the edge of the island and he closes his eyes and he opens them and he realises he's still running and he's on water. And it's when he makes that little realisation, he makes that little laugh and runs off. I just love that. It's just that I look forward to that bit in the movie.
Yeah.
It's just a really good little feel-good bit, that bit there when it's like, oh, look what I can do. Fuck it. I'm out of here.
Yeah.
Let's see. My two favourite characters in the whole film are Edna Mode, without doubt. I love Edna Mode's character. Really, really well done. Really well voiced by Brad Bird as well.
Yeah.
How quite he channeled Elton John and Yoko Ono, I'll never know, but it was brilliant.
it's a remarkable achievement. Candle in the wind, and then off he goes. Now capes.
Stay in touch, darling. Yeah, fantastic. Yeah. My other favourite character is Jack-Jack. I just love the kid in it.
Really?
I really like Jack-Jack. He's not in there all the time, but when he's on there, for me, it's like, you know, things he does, just that one character, the way they animate it, the way, no matter what's going on between the family, they're all losing it, and he's sitting there smiling his head off. You know, to him, it's all a big game.
Yeah.
I especially like the bit at the end where he gets kidnapped by Syndrome and then he just fucking loses it. it's fucking brilliant. Again, where that character's concerned, if you've watched the movie on DVD, watch Jack-Jack Attack. Story of babysitter. What happens to her when she's making those phone calls to Elastigirl? It's just fucking excellent. It really is. Again, fantastic piece. In general, the whole feel of the movie is great. I love that that thing where the supers get taken down and they're like, you know, they're relegated and been told, you know, you can't do this anymore. You've got to stop it, and they get taken to court. That whole sort of air of sadness and darkness mixed in there together, I love that.
I especially love the irony of the guy actually suing him for rescuing him and breaking and giving him whiplash, even though he was committing suicide.
Yeah, you know, it's I really like all that element about it. I love the look of it. You know, it's just such a really great looking film. You know.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I've got all of the Art of Pixar books, and I get every one as they come out, even if I don't like the film. And I have to say, some of the work that was done on this film, some of the artwork is amazing. And just the design stuff is just astounding stuff. It's brilliant.
You know what? You could make, if you took that same sort of look, you could quite happily make an old-style James Bond film.
Well, that was a lot of the influence. I mean, you know, all those kind of... Yeah, some of the island, tropical island stuff was, I think, nicked from like The Man with the Golden Gun, and one of the other Roger Moore ones. I think it was like The Spy Who Loved Me, and there was also Oh God,
you only live twice.
You only live
there
twice
as well.
In there. Yeah, absolutely. And there's lots of that kind of stuff. And
there's also Thunderbirds as well, because kind of those great secret bases in the Gerry Anderson shows were designed by a guy called Derek Meddings, who went on to design all the supervillain bases for the Bond films.
Yeah,
and it captures that really beautifully. I think.
Yeah, it's an astounding astounding aesthetic to kind of make it look retro, but yet give it enough of a modern edge with like the way the villains look and some of Syndrome's equipment, like the zero point energy thing. I mean, it's a great melding and it just creates a world so well rounded that it just it's gorgeous. But anyway, sorry, I'm going off on a tangent.
No. I'll tell you what, there's also something else they do in this film which a lot of superhero movies don't address, and that's the science of superheroes, right? That's the way they actually tick things, how things work. Like when Frozone and Incredible were inside the building, they're rescuing people, and they talk about why they can't do the frost, you know, and it goes into detail about that. And the whole thing about the capes, you know, it's like the cape is probably the most useless piece of equipment that most superheroes can have. I mean, Superman's got one. What's he got it for?
Yeah, exactly. What's
he need for? He doesn't need it. Batman, all right, fine. It's a piece of kit that he does actually use. But, you know, you think about how many other superheroes have got capes. It's like, why have they got capes?
Well, I mean, it does make me laugh. That whole montage of all the things that happen to all the different superheroes. I mean, I especially like the one, I think, is it he has his what, cape tied to a rocket. He's fired off.
You see him go, oh, and then the boots are just the only thing that's left.
Yeah, exactly. But even that, I mean, you know, Bird says that he's never read Watchmen. But I have to say that even that's a throwback to Watchmen, where it says about, I can't remember who it is.
Dollar Bill.
Dollar Bill, that's it. He gets his cape caught in a revolving door and he gets shot to death.
And exactly.
Yeah.
It's great. Little things like that. You know, it's good. And also the thing as well about, you know, where they have like superheroes that are incredibly strong and they can stop a truck literally dead. Well, it's like that wouldn't happen because you'd have to be braced to be able to do that. And it shows you in that when Incredible tries to stop the train and he gets pushed along the track.
Yeah.
You know, that sort of thing. I love that. Little things like that. I think make a difference.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, rather than, what was it, like Hancock, when Will Smith just stands in front of the train and just like rams into him and wraps around him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, fair enough. It's a cool effect, but fucking hell, it wouldn't happen. That's not how it, you know.
Yeah, no one sees the train driver still hurtling down the track at 400 mile an hour after going through the window. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. So before I get on to what I was thinking about it, there's been a lot of talk on the Facebook group and elsewhere. But like, do you think this is the best Pixar movie? Or not? I mean, what would you think? Do you think it's one of the best or the best? I mean, where do you think it rates?
Off the top of my head, I'd have to say yes, just because of its rewatchability for me. It's like I say, it never gets old. It's got that certain something.
Well, what about you, Jim?
I think it's a close call between The Incredibles and Toy Story. What's the best Pixar movie? But I think the thing with Toy Story is it is a kid's movie. It's a brilliant kid's movie, one of the best ever kid's movies, but it's still a kid's movie.
Yeah.
Whereas The Incredibles is just a great movie, full stop.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
You know, it appeals across the board to all ages, I think. You know, in a far more rounded and satisfying way.
Yeah, I think that's fair enough. I mean,
by the way, sorry, go on.
No, go on.
I was going to say just a bit of trivia. Talking about kids, you know the little boy that when Thingy lifts up the car and the little boy's sitting there on the trike.
Yeah.
Apparently, the kid who did the voice for that was Brad Bird's son. So I love that. That was wicked.
Yeah, I have to admit, I mean, I was a little trepidatious coming back to this for this review.
Yeah,
because I mean, I have seen this film. This is probably the film of Pixar's I have watched the most, closely followed on its heels by Finding Nemo and then Monsters, Inc., which get sort of regular rotation in my house. But I have to say, I was a little bit worried because I was thinking, if I sit there and watch it like an adult,
yeah,
you know, rather than just like, oh, it's just fun, wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, going on in the background, and actually sit and watch it, will I still like it? And I've got to say, I really loved this film. I watched it this time round, no kids around, no one to distract me, and which isn't difficult, seeing as they're at school and I've got a foot the size of a small moon at the moment. But it's like, I sat there, and I tell you what, I really enjoyed. I really enjoyed all the family stuff. I really enjoyed that more than I'd had before. I think, you know, before it's like, oh, get to the superheroics, let's get on with it. But what I really appreciated this time around was the work that goes into that sort of family unit, that kind of, it's all quickly sort of hooked together. And a lot of it's like, you know, sort of pretty standard sort of fare that you see in most dramas, you know. You know, where have you been? What time do you call this? And all this kind of thing. Mm. And, you know, and the kids are sitting there on the stairs listening to mum and dad fighting and all this kind of thing. But I actually have to say that's the sort of thing you don't see in a kid's movie and don't see done really well. And then the whole montage sequence, you know, which is kind of like, you know, he's going off to work and he's wearing his suit and he's getting a little trimmer, and then Lasty Girl's arm comes out and pulls him back in for another... Yeah, how'd you do? And it just seemed like it was never... It always feels to me like The Incredibles was never really meant to be a kid's film. And the fact that it was CG just is, you know, which appeals to children, is just by the by. And, you know, Pixar's name on it is almost, you know, inconsequential as well. It was really... It's an adult cartoon in a lot of ways. I mean, there are obviously, you know, the stuff for the kids, the big robots and what have you. But that what struck me this time was how adult it was in terms of content and what the ideas it was trying to put across. You know, not just a midlife crisis, but the fact that, you know, the you know, Bob Parr is basically sitting there and he's in an office job that's sort of crushing his soul. He's not doing what he wants to. He can't do it because he's doing this for the family, and you know, all that stuff that, you know, the Brad Bird brought to it, that whole sort of balancing between home life and, you know, your own internal needs and all this sort of thing. It was a really, really, this time around, it really struck me. Once all you get into the superheroics, and, you know, we've had the inevitable argument of Elastigirl sort of finding out what's going on, you know, that's, yeah, the film just kicks back into sort of standard Pixar fare, but with superheroes. But for me, that whole opening sort of third really, really sort of really struck me this time how well done it was and how well observed it was. Even the bit when they're sitting in the car with he's sitting with Frozone, and he's and they're going, you know what? Instead of sitting here in the radio pretending we go bowling, why don't we actually go bowling? You know, it's that kind of... They're both just sitting there bored in a car. It's just like... Mm-hmm. And I just love all that kind of stuff. And it was just so well observed. It was so well done. And like I say, 90% of it, I think, goes over the kids' heads 9 times out of 10. But, yeah. And then once the main adventure kicks off... Once Bob's been sort of conned and he's been attacked and he finds out what happens to all the other superheroes, the film shifts gear to Elastigirl, and I have to say that she stops being the sort of slightly annoying, slightly naggy character, and she comes into her own, and each character gets their little moment in the sun, and I really enjoyed that. And in fact, I enjoyed her sequences when she's breaking into the base.
Yes, really, really good. Again, James Bond.
Yeah, but really nicely observed, really nicely done. I mean, like, you look at some of the stuff like the Fantastic Four films, you know, where the closest you get to Reed Richards doing anything vaguely Reed Richards-y is sticking his hands under a fucking door and, you know, opening a door from the inside. Whereas there's this sequence, you know, that sequence where she's basically got trapped in a door, and then stretching herself to get trapped in another door.
Yeah.
And then having to stretch a little bit further and get trapped in another door. Then smack someone in the face. And all the kung fu stuff where her legs and arms are going in every direction. It's like, fucking hell. That's when you see the power of something like CG and animation. Because to do that live action, well, as we saw, it's like, that's fucking I can't even remember the name of the guy who plays fucking Reed Richards in the Fantastic Four, but it's like, you know, it's him with a couple of sticks on his arms like fucking Mr. Nosey Bonk, but in you know, in the Incredibles, it's like, this is a realistic way of doing it. This is how it would happen. The suit stretches with her, but the, you know, you don't get sort of like that big stretchy boot that sort of starts halfway up a leg because they've just changed the lens, you know, and her toes get 400 feet long. It's really nicely done, and I have to say, I do think it is quite possibly the best superhero movie ever made, because it takes the idea and it runs with it, and it doesn't do an origin story, and it doesn't do, it doesn't really do any of this kind of the standard thing with superheroes where you kind of have to have, you know. Yeah, they can't do their powers. You know, it would cost too much to show the powers all the time, so we can't really have any sort of major action sequences except at the beginning to establish the character and the end to, you know, to show that they've beaten the villain. You know, in this you've got everything. You've got the, like you say, Rusty doing his dash through the, you know, through the water. You got Violet doing that thing where she's sort of like making the shield, and they're rolling along in the shield across the ground and using it like a Zorb. Then you got Elastigirl's sort of whole thing of her breaking into the base, which is just some of the best choreography I've seen. That whole thing where she swings around on the monorail, and then she swings under the monorail, and then she's going around the outside. Then she goes flat because they go through the tunnel. And it's just like, it's just beautifully done. You just can't help but be impressed by the work that went into it as much as the story it's telling. And I love The Incredibles, and I loved it more this time around because I was watching it as an adult, watching an adult film, as opposed to sitting there watching a kid's film. I have to say, pointy toe feet aside, I'd say it was really well done. I think if I had any criticism at all, and it's not much of a criticism, but if I had any criticism at all, I think the subtlety of the characters, the other superheroes going missing, kind of passed me by a little bit. And it was only when I sort of think back on it that it's like, you suddenly see, oh, this person's been missing for ages, oh, that person's been missing for ages, oh, that person didn't show up for work today, and all this kind of thing, and all these little side things that get thrown in, and you see like one or two in a newspaper or some, you know, these people have turned up dead or something, and it's like, yeah, they were a little too subtle with the other superheroes being taken away. Didn't make so much of a mystery of it. You know, I mean, use Watchmen as an example. You know, the whole of Watchmen, the opening of Watchmen is essentially Rorschach going, someone's killing heroes, you know, sort of thing. Or killing capes, you know, killing capes and I want to know why. Whereas what the eventual fate of all these other superheroes and why it happened wasn't as well set up as it could have been. I think they could have done a little bit more on that, but for the rest of it, I just loved it. I just absolutely loved it. And I think Syndrome is a fantastic little sideswipe at fandom.
Yeah, definitely.
I think everything... I mean, I know I'm a nerd, I know I'm a fan, and I could be fanboy about lots of stuff, but I have to say, I do honestly think that was a big fuck you to a lot of sort of overly clingy fans that maybe someone in Pixar, or maybe Brad Bird himself, has kind of experienced that kind of entitled, I'm going to sit here with you and you're going to sit here with me and we are going to go and solve crimes. You know, go home, buddy. And that whole line of, you know, when everyone's super, then no one will be. You know, it's all a bit Aaron Rand, I guess. It was a bit weird. But, yeah, anyway, I totally loved it. I thought it was a fantastic film. I think it's one of Pixar's best, if not the best. And I genuinely find it was a fun, engaging, exciting film. It wasn't cartoon in my eyes. It was a film. It was a really good one.
Yeah.
There you go. That's all I've got to say on the matter.
Just one more thing. I think this every time it gets to the end of the movie. You know the actual theme at the end?
Hmm.
I would love to be, you know, when they do those like live orchestral, you know, they actually get the orchestra in, they do those tunes live.
Hmm.
I would love to be present when they do this, something like that with this theme tune, and just recreate it. I've always wanted to do that, just hear it done live. Okay. Yeah. And maybe have the title sequence or the end sequence playing on a big video screen, but just having a proper orchestra.
Yeah,
come out and do that. I love that. The end tune. It's great.
Oh, cool. Well, guess what we're playing out with tonight, ladies and gentlemen.
Hey.
So, anything else to add before we move on to feedback? Anyone? Bueller? No. Bueller? cool. I mean, I have to say, while I'm getting the iPad and using this as an excuse, I would say, I thought some of the set design, especially the volcano, the lava door, created some, was really well done, really nicely done. But then I'm going to keep saying that all the way through, so I better just crack on, I think. So nice, it was so cool. I also love Edna's testing range for the clothes.
Oh, darling, this is the latest of designs. I think you'll find it.
It's like Egyptian cotton.
It's as tough as steel. Oh, yes, he came in, had his super suit.
Yeah, anyway. Never mind. So, yes, we got quite a bit of feedback here. And what we shall do is we shall start off with Chris Johnson, Spaceman 3000 on Twitter, 300, sorry, Spaceman 300 on Twitter, and yes, and inhabitor of all known Facebook groups known to man. And he writes, hello DIY man and IT boy. I think The Incredibles is one of the best superhero movies. It has everything a comic book and a movie fan needs. Chris. I don't know if that means everyone needs Chris. Or if it's... But anyway, that was...
Now that's a sitcom waiting to happen.
Everybody needs Chris. So thank you very much for that, Chris. And moving on, we have Murray Christensen, Pie Man, who regularly feeds back to the Org cast, which you can find on Geek Planet Online. And he writes, hello, gentlemen. Well, The Incredibles, or rather, the best Fantastic Four movie ever made. When I heard of this film, I was ready to hate it. It just seemed so much like a wholesale rip-off of the Fantastic Four, and there didn't seem to be any acknowledgement of this in any of the promotional gubbins. It wasn't helped when I heard people complaining that the Fantastic Four were a rip-off of The Incredibles. I had to calm the nerd rage to stop myself looking like some kind of nutter in the street screaming at random passers-by. This all changed when I saw the film, though. I enjoyed it more than the Fantastic Four films. Superheroics aside, I loved the way that even stuck in a dead-end job, Mr. Incredible tries to be heroic. Even if it's heroically helping old ladies with insurance claims. Yes, I love that bit. I'm not telling you this, but if you do this, par. And then when he gets his boss and throws him through like seven walls.
Yeah.
Next time you see him, he's all in like the fucking braces and everything. Anyway, sorry, carry on. Sorry, just recalling it. On this rewatch, it's still a damn good film. I hadn't thought of it borrowing from Watchmen as well until it was mentioned in last week's cast, but there is definitely influences here. So overall, while the film doesn't do anything particularly original, what it does very well, and as a result, it's more than the sum of its parts. Enjoying the podcast, and also, as always, keep up the good work. Murray Pieman Christensen. Thank you very much for that, Murray. Yeah, I must admit, it's got that heroes thing about it, where by deconstructing superhero, the superhero genre, you end up kind of eventually ending up in a sort of Watchmen-style place. I don't know if that's a damning indictment on Watchmen, to be honest, or not. Everyone ends up in the same place, even if they haven't read Watchmen. Alan Moore has thought up Watchmen, but all he just basically did was get there first. But well, controversial. Wait for the Alan Moore purists to start firebombing my house in 3, 2, 1. Oh God, they're coming through the windows. Anyway, I'm sorry. Moving on. Next piece of feedback is from Elton McManus of the Shonky Lab. Which you can find at shonkylab.co.uk and on iTunes. And Elton writes, "Hi guys, sorry it's been so long between feedbacks. Hopefully I'll find a bit more time in the future. So, The Incredibles, Pixar's best film bar none. The story, animation and thought that went into every single aspect of this movie, from the grainy intros to the very stylized outro, were all top draw. The movie seems to take all the cliches of the superhero movie and twist them into something that feels fresh. For instance, Bob is captured and has to be rescued by his family. Bob also hides his superhero trips from his wife, and their relationship blossoms again. And what a wife." Yeah, we knew someone had to get to it, didn't we? We knew someone. It might as well be Elton. Thank you. Here we go. Right. What's next? Here we go. "If I had to pick the hottest animated character ever, then Elastigirl is it. She's very bendy." Do you know what? I have to say, I'm surprised we got through three feedbacks before getting to this point.
I'm surprised we got through the main section before getting to this bit.
I know. That's the thing, isn't it? Being so over-enthusiastic, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, I haven't noticed. I have to say, though, if you had Elastigirl, if you had the power of Elastigirl, wouldn't you actually bend your shape into something a little less, so you wouldn't be staring at your ass in the mirror because your costume doesn't fit right? Wouldn't you just like make yourself a little bit taller and just suck the arse in a bit?
I'd just be sitting in the mirror staring at my arse, let's be honest.
Yeah, I mean, let's be honest.
I wouldn't have left the house.
Yeah.
Ever.
Yeah. Why have you been in the toilet for at least 4 hours? Shut up! I don't need an extra vertebrae. Hooray! I've got breath mints. You seem to be getting through... Sitting for a lot of mouthwash, Jim. Shut up. Why do your pants always smell of Listerine? Oh, God. Anyway, back to Elton's feedback. He moves on from the bendy thing and goes, "This film has some genius touches throughout. Frozen drinking a small cup of water, then freezing the cop and his bullet. Edna Mode's now capes. Syndrome's expanding sticky balls." Yes.
What he was wearing lycra.
Bob's boss being a knob, etc. It's all a testament to the strength of the story that Elastigirl's pilot friend and Syndrome creeping into the Incredibles' house one night were actually taken out. The story didn't gain anything from these plots, so they weren't even shoehorned in. The film leaves you wanting more on the snap of the closing credits. All in all, it's a all in all, it's the Bojangles, and I won't hear of anyone saying that a bag of dead puppies, Wall-E, or slightly dull after the first 10 minutes up are any better. Bravo, Pixar. Bravo, Elton.
Hey.
Thank you very much for that, Elton. So, back to Elastigirl. Stretchy. Yes. Oh, dear. Do you know, I'm not even gonna start that conversation because I was about to say something that would have just landed me in jail, I think. But anyway. Yeah, for the good of it all. Right. So, last piece of written feedback is from Jack P. Starro, Otter Puncher.
Yeah.
If they've got clams and they're within 500 yards of us, we're already dead. We do have to start giving everyone else different animal punching names, I think.
Well, I did say we should set up a roster.
A roster?
Yeah, yeah, okay. of call signs. Okay, you know?
So Jack's Otter Puncher.
Yeah.
What, seeing as you're a guest on the show, Jim, what would you like to be? Ocelot Fondler? Eagle Manipulator?
Beaver Wrangler.
Okay, Beaver Wrangler it is. You heard it first here, folks.
Oh, God.
Jim Moon, Beaver Wrangler.
Yeah. You want a damn building in a hurry? Jim's your man.
You want a need your beaver fondling or wrangling?
Nice beaver. Thank you, I just had it stuffed. God. God. Anyway, moving on. Jack P. Otter Puncher star. Ahoy there, gents. At last, a movie to feedback on that I truly love. Oddly, though, I reckon this is only my third time of seeing it, and the first time in quite a few years. I'd say so. There are some validity to checking out my potential rose tinting of any specs. Well, fuck that shit right up the cacker. My memories of this movie are so far from rose-tinted that it's impossible, as impossible as it may seem, I actually enjoy this film more than when I first saw it. Maybe my tastes have changed a smidgen. Perhaps it's the influence of revising so many postmodern superhero deconstructions in the interim due to the studying for my thesis, but this shit is off the freaking chain, bitches. It's very rare that I would dare to utter the dangerous words perfect movie. But for me, this comes close. The pacing, the dialogue, the characterization, the visual directing, the design, the acting, the animation are all pretty much flawless and wrapped up in a plot that, while straightforward and even one I could recall fairly well, was utterly engrossing. Seriously, I could crap on endlessly about this movie. It's about quarter to four in the morning and I'm wasted, so please forgive me if I'm dropping some random thoughts on you. 1. I absolutely love how, for all of its wry humour and mild deconstruction of superhero tropes, this film actually takes its subject matter absolutely seriously and with great reverence. Brad Bird obviously loves the Silver Age comic quite deeply, and it's writ large in the way that he treats the superhero ethic and ethos with joyful integrity. 2. That does, however, seep into perhaps the only real criticism of the film, which is that the mild tendency towards deconstruction in pointing out that bad guy goons are not kind of Saturday morning cartoon baddies, but rather can and will try to kill children, kind of backfires in that also shows our heroes being prepared to kill them in return. This is one of my fanish pet peeves in Batman movies, where heroes are shown to dispatch henchmen in ways that, although not graphic, are clearly fatal. As well as the infection of the prevailing Hollywood logic that the main villain must die at the end. Call me wet, sopping, great pussy if you must, but for a film that's not only gently unpacking the conventions of superhero-dom, in kids' movie no less, while mostly celebrating them, it's a misstep. I could go along with Dash and Violet accidentally killing goons in self-defense due to their inexperience, but when Helen and Bob do it, even in defense of their kids, it unsettles me. It's a breaking a cardinal rule that of the type and tradition that superheroes in this film are paying loving homage to, and it cheats, frankly, by having no open acknowledgement of the fact that people have just died. It wants to have its cake and eat it when it comes to injecting the higher stakes into the retro sensibility. And when Bob quite deliberately, if technically indirectly, due to the no capes, kills Syndrome in the end after his wife and baby are already safe, well, that's just caving into Hollywood's ingrained demand for tidy closed arc in which the villain gets his comeuppance with no further consequences. My only other remotely critical observation is that I find it a little confusing as to what Bob is doing during the 2 months between his first and second trips to the island. We see him spending the money, working out and getting frisky with Helen now that his mojo is back. I adore the tastefully implied sexuality in this film, by the way. But is that it? What does he do all day while he's pretending to still go to the office? Just work out? Did he know he was going to get called out again for working for more Syndrome's henchwoman? Which reminds me, she's totally the second Bond girl in any given Bond movie, right? I swear that as much as this film is a superhero love letter, it's almost one is as much of one for Bond movies, or specifically to Bond villains. I could go all academic on your asses about the greater genre fluidity of supervillain tropes and their heroic counterparts, but I think the film speaks for itself about how seamlessly all the homages and crazy aesthetics, lairs, goons, rockets and megalomaniacal plans of 60s Bond villains all fit into this film's comic book supervillain genre. For indeed, the villain of the piece is certainly the masterstroke of the script, perhaps less in the character of Syndrome himself, who might be more compelling if you were a bit more idiosyncratic and less of a one on the nose as a parody of fanboys generally, but rather his function in driving a rather cracking plot. However, when he turns sinister, and in certain moments he is truly creepy, I think the concept of fanboy sidekick turned bad is one of the film's best bits of genre twisting. And although my memory is hazy about who predicted what, it's clearly a thing in the mid-noughties of superhero zeitgeist, with nearly simultaneous resurrections in comics of former sidekicks Jason Todd and Bucky as antagonists to their former partners, as well as the bizarre recreation of Superboy Prime into the hysterical fanboy gone mad, smacked oddly of raising a middle finger to their own readership. Also, Syndrome embedded allusions to Jimmy Olsen in the character's appearance and narrative introduction, which is interesting, in that he wasn't a bona fide psychic, but just a hanger-on. Even his name, Buddy, seems to be an intentional slang synonym for pal, which being pal, being Jimmy Olsen's common Silver Age appellation and title of his own comic, as in Superman's pal, Jimmy Olsen. Because, you know, the film does indicate that Bob initially humoured Buddy until he grew too presumptuous. This could be some kind of weird metacritique on Superman and Jimmy Olsen's relationship as being nonsensical and emotionally in an emotionally realistic take on superheroes, as thought to ask why superheroes would condescend to treat a civilian youth as his pal. Or maybe 5 years of seriously studying this stuff has just started to infect my brain. Okay, a few quick stray thoughts. Then, as now, on rewatching, I'm surprised by the film's almost studious lack of call-outs, even sidelong references to real existing superheroes, even within the limits of what they could legally get away with. There are, of course, some obvious similarities to the Fantastic Four, given the family unit, Helen and Violet's powers especially, and the aesthetic of their team uniform. But these still don't feel like shout-outs. In fact, I remember with distaste reading in a glossy mainstream press when some ignorant dipshit of so-called journalist reported that the forthcoming first Fantastic Four movie seemed like a rip-off of The Incredibles. Sigh. Would it be fair to say that this movie has been the best superhero action flick ever? Perhaps it is the skill of the animator and the inherent control and the lack of limits imparted by animation, but I can't see any live-action movie ever topping this, because it would, ironically enough, have to almost completely give over to using digital doubles as actors. While I love the Parr family characters as pitch-perfect marriages of design, animation and vocal performances, it's weird that in addition to being really awesome character, I think Helen is pretty fucking sexy. Maybe it's the ghetto booty.
Here we go again.
Here we go yes. again. Yeah. Maybe it's the ghetto booty. Maybe it's Holly Hunter's cute speech impediment. Or maybe I just have a subconscious MILF thing going on. But I adore this character. And the way that she's both deeply human and highly competent superhero is just wonderful. I think it's the first time I saw this film, I was more absorbed by Bob's story. But this time around, I found the most riveting moments to be when Helen was protecting her kids and sneaking around the base, getting her own superheroic mojo back. Okay, gents, sorry for being so epic, but this was an epic fucking film, and I've got some epic fucking love for it. Later, boys, gotta go punch some otters. Cheers, Jack. Thank you very much for that, Jack.
Cheers, Jack.
Most appreciated. Well, there's quite a bit to chew over there. I mean, I first thing came to my mind is, yes, absolutely. I'm surprised that they never had any slyer sides to, you know, Batman or... superhero, you know, superhumans or Iron Men or, you know, anything like that. It's quite interesting that it creates its own unique universe. So that's quite, I have to say, the more I think about it, it's quite clever. The other thing I was going to say was about the Fantastic Four movie being like The Incredibles. It is a small trivia piece, which is essentially that after seeing The Incredibles, the writers of Fantastic Four and the director had to sit down and rethink some of their set pieces because they were too close to what the Incredibles were doing. At least that's the rumour. I would say that basically they tried to jump on the coattails by releasing that story. Oh yes, we could have been like that, but we made it better. Actually, no, you didn't. In fact, you know what? I would say Susan Storm, not a touch on Helen Parr. There you go. Come on. I mean, I know it's Jessica Alba, but, you know, Jessica Alba in a blonde wig looking slightly vacant. I mean, the suit's good, but, you know, she's no Helen Parr. I think we can all agree.
Definitely.
I think we're all on the same page for this one.
Yes, it's one on DeviantArt, I believe. But anyhow.
Right next to the Jessica Rabbit pictures. yes, ghetto booty. God almighty, in fact, maybe that's what I'll call this podcast. I'm going to call this ghetto booty.
Ghetto booty, right.
Ghetto booty. Elastic ghetto booty. Oh, bloody hell, there's so much of that, Jack. I don't know where to start coming in on it. Jimmy Olsen thing. Go on, sorry.
I was going to say, the killing thing. I think it is a kind of... I like the fact that at the end, they don't just lead Syndrome off in chains, that he becomes a victim of bird strike.
Yes.
That does give it an edge that supposedly family film you wouldn't expect.
Yeah.
But at the same time, there is the thing of kind of... they do actually kill a lot of people, don't they?
There is an awful lot. But then you say that. I mean, it's like... come on, I mean, I know superheroes aren't supposed to kill people, and deconstruction of superheroes always means that you have to kill people. But let's be honest, most kids of that particular age, of the target age for this thing, about sort of what the standard Pixar age is about 7, isn't it? 7 or 8.
I'm not sure.
I think that's kind of what they reckon it. I mean, this is probably the most sort of standardized way of getting through that sort of, you know, most sort of easy way of getting through that kind of everyone has to die, things has to happen. I mean, bloody hell, The Lion King has people die in it. I mean, you know, or Star Wars, if you want to go that far back. I mean, it's like, okay, how many stormtroopers die? How many people on the Death Star die? How many people on board the fucking ship at the beginning die? I mean, you know, and kids would have watched that. I think death with superheroes being a shocker, right? I don't know. For me, it's... I think with the, especially in the case of The Incredibles, where they aren't actually, you know, bona fide superheroes anymore. They're just people defending themselves that just happen to have superpowers. I kind of... because the way it was presented, the superheroes were, like, endorsed by the government, whereas this is kind of like they are free agents. They aren't held by any laws or any rules. I mean, I don't know. I didn't see a big deal with with the death and destruction angle.
Well, they are defending themselves. It's not like Elastic Girl is garrotting goons on her way in.
No.
You know, in that kind of thoughtless sort of, in that sort of James Bond, you know, sort of, fuck you, fuck you, got milk, fuck you, you know, eat milk carved. you know, kind of way. It's, and I think also, I mean, with the kids killing people, killing goons as well, well, you give most kids school powers and there'll be massacres over.
Yeah.
Over not buying a comic, never mind if they'll be having to defend themselves, you know. But,
yeah.
I mean, it's like one of those things. I mean, I think, yeah, it's easy to forget what a child's mind is like. They say, yeah, cool, fuck him. I mean, you know, people always worry about violence in children's programs, but it's mainly parents doing the worrying. The kids are, what? They pulled his head off? Could you see the bone?
Yeah. Actually, it was quite funny. It's just going off on a tangent again, but I have to say, I was playing a Mass Effect game, and Katie was just sitting there on the sofa, and Lisa was miles away. She was just doing something, and then all of a sudden, I did a headshot on one of the bad guys, and his head just popped clean off into a gout of blood, and I completely forgot how gory it was. And Katie was just looking open mouthed, and I thought, oh shit, I've got to explain this now, and she went, that was cool. Do it again. I'm like, oh, if you like, I can decapitate him again. If you like, yeah, use the sniper rifle. Make him go up in the air before you do it. Oh, right, okay. So I think kids are quite happy with that kind of stuff. Right, okay. Well, I think what we're going to do now is we're going to move on to some MP3 feedback. We got quite a bit of it this week. The first bit of feedback is from the Reverend Peter Organ of the Orgcast, which, you, as I said before, you can find on geekplanetonline.com. You can also find it on iTunes. And if you are anyway a fan of Star Trek Next Generation and swearing at spaceships and basically calling out the older stories, then get on over there and listen to Pete's and Anne-Marie's podcast, which is very good.
Hear...
So we just watched
what
one of our
had
kids
to say
DVDs
about the Incredibles
without them because they've gone to bed. We did invite them to watch it with us, but they weren't interested.
No.
Hey ho.
Never mind. You're going to do Wall-E at some point?
I can see that happening. Wall-E is an excellent film. It's one of my favouritest films of all time.
It's cool.
Yeah, this is the first Pixar film I didn't like. I mean, they had a perfect run up till now, and you choose to do this one first. Confusing.
I like this film, but perhaps for the wrong reasons.
Why do you like this film?
I went to see it in the cinema with my friend Louise, whose brother is a twat. Her brother is also ginger, and her brother also thinks that he ought to be more important than he is. So not very long into the film, we said that her brother was syndrome and therefore got an awful lot more enjoyment out of it than we might otherwise have done.
So you have very specific reasons for liking this film, then.
And then guess who came and picked us up and ran us home?
Oh, dear.
Yeah, and we just spent the whole time sitting in the back of the car looking at each other and trying not to giggle. But I also like this film because I have never liked Robin. I have never liked sidekicks. I always think children superhero type sidekick ward things are bollocks and twats and need slapping in the face. And this, you know, I'm right.
He's very good, actually.
I like it for that reason as well.
Right. I like the second half. I always forget when I sit down to watch this film and I get more and more annoyed with it that actually the second half is really good. But I have to grip my teeth and get through the first half. And the reason why I don't like the first half is it's all the domestic stuff winds me up. I don't watch superhero films for domesticity. I watch them for people using their superpowers. I particularly don't watch superhero films for heroes being sued, heroes working as an insurance salesman, for crud's sake, and heroes dealing with troublesome kids and rowing. It's worse than fucking Peter Parker, and he's annoying enough as it is. So yeah, the first half's awful, and but basically wants to get to the island, and it all kicks off. It's brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. Samuel L. Jackson's great, although he's not in it enough.
No.
But he's really good. Whoever the guy is who's playing Mr. Incredible is doing a bloody good Adam West. All credit to the voice work on that. And whoever's doing the music clearly wants to do the music for a Bond film.
Totally.
Only Live Twice, the reboot.
Yeah, I mean, I did get that the whole way through.
Yeah, and there's a lot of You Only Live Twice in this, actually, isn't there? The old volcano base and little bubble cars. And
ninjas. And
so basically, half a really good film and half a really irritating film. But that's just my proclivities. I hate domesticity in superhero films.
See, I like the first half because it shows just what a twat Incrediboy is. For me, for Incrediboy, for Incrediboy, read Robin. Ergo, I am right.
Okay, yeah, half a good movie,
3/4 of a good movie, I'd say.
Put us together, and we mostly like it. Yeah, so there we go. On average, we mostly like this film.
Yes.
Cheers, bye, guys.
Bye.
So it's 3/4 of a good movie, as long as you know ginger twats who are full of themselves. that's kind of that. Yeah, they should put that on the poster. It's 3/4 of a good movie, as long as you hate ginger twats. And it's no good if you like domesticity in your superhero movies. Well, thank you very much for that. Anybody got anything to add to that?
Well, Amory makes a very good point, actually, that it is subverting that whole idea of the sidekick.
Yes.
And sidekicks are twats.
Mm. Exactly.
And that's something, actually, that Watchmen doesn't address at all, the whole sidekick archetype and mythos.
No.
Whereas The Incredibles does to brilliant effect.
Yes, yeah. It's certainly, yeah, I was going to say that I think Jack made, Otter Puncher, sorry, to use his Metal Gear Solid name. Otter Puncher made a very good point about that as well. He's sort of with Jason Todd in Batman coming back as Hush, or Bucky Barnes coming back as the Winter Soldier in Captain America. So, yeah, I that was all around about the same time. So, I don't know. It's good. It's a good point. I think. You know, everyone hates the fucking sidekick. No one wants the sidekick. Now it just gives you a legitimate reason to hate the sidekick, because you're going to go off and become a bastard. There you go. That's what we've come to the conclusion. There you go. So, thank you very much for that, Pete and Anne-Marie. As far as doing Wally, I when I was listening to that, and the other guys all confirm this, as we were listening to that, are you going to do Wally? No. I have to say, I despise Wally. I just generally can't do cute robots, except for Silent Running. That makes me cry. But otherwise, I mean, we will do Wally. I'm sure we'll do Wally. But it's just, I have to say, I would have to be left in a darkened room listening to a lot of Cradle of Filth for a long time before I would have enough resistance to get up and sit there and get the saccharine blast of both Peter Gabriel and singing about the trees and a doe-eyed robot having a love affair with an iPod. I'm sorry. I need some preparation time for that one, I think. Anyway, on to our next piece of MP3 feedback, and it is from a friend of the show, Tom Elliott, of the late lamented Gentleman's Grindhouse. Does Tom do the Twilight Zone cast still?
Yes,
yes, he does. I thought he did.
He's just launched a blog in which you can hear him interviewing Barbie Wilde. Horror author, and probably most famous for being the female Cenobite in Hellraiser.
Yes. Mm. Very good. Well, there you go. Do you know, we'll find out the blog details and put them on after his feedback, I think, because Tom is a great writer. And like I say,
Tom,
Gentleman's Grindhouse was a great little podcast.
Long lamented. The Incredibles.
And, well, let's hear what he has to say
about
The Incredibles.
If you sort of break it down into its component parts, and each of those parts is just almost a work of genius. You know, the design of the thing, the sort of retro-futuristic look of it, the superhero costumes, great voice cast, great backstory to the characters and the world in general. You know, beautifully animated and just so great in so many ways. I think one of its main positives is that it distills what we already know about superheroes and superhero comics and movies and so on into something new. It kind of takes the essence of all those things but creates its own thing. So you will watch it and you might see shades of Fantastic Four, you might see shades of Superman or so many other things, but it's not just a copy of those things and just aping them. It transforms it into something new, and I think that's what's really great about The Incredibles. What will probably come as a bit of surprise, and I'm probably the only person who's going to be saying this, is that I don't actually like the movie as a whole. I think I just can't put my finger on why. That's the problem, because if you do break it down into its component parts, like I say, it's perfection in so many ways, but added together, it just leaves me cold. It should be right up my street. I love superheroes. I love superhero movies. I like Pixar movies. But The Incredibles, just the more it goes on, the more it loses me. And I don't know whether it's because it's just missing some heart or some intangible factor that actually makes me care about these characters. But it's just, you know, less than the sum of its parts as far as I'm concerned. You know, nobody's more surprised at that than me. You know, it should be right down my alley. You know, as everyone who knows me knows, I'm a big horror fan, and there's a lot of horror movies that I think, you know, you can say, well, the acting's shit, the, you know, it's shot badly, the effects are a bit shoddy, but it's got a great energy about it, and it kind of becomes more than the sum of its parts because it does have a great energy about it, and, you know, it makes you care for it in some way. To me, The Incredibles is the opposite. It's less than the sum of its parts, and its parts individually are fantastic, but altogether, it just leaves me cold. And, you know, nobody's more surprised at that than me, but I thought I would put that in there just to, you know, be a different voice in the crowd. I'm no film snob, you know. I love all Pixar movies, well, most of them. So there you go. I'm sorry I couldn't give a bit of better feedback or give a better reason for, you know, it was something that I could actually spark a bit of debate, but it's not really. It's just me saying I don't like the movie, so I apologise about that. But, you know, I don't begrudge anyone else their enjoyment of any movie, so I'm glad that you like it, and I'm sure that everyone else will, and that's absolutely fine. Have a good show, gents. I'll see you later. Bye.
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 Thank you very much for that, Tom.
That's a lovely bit of feedback. And you know what? That's fine. If you don't like it, you don't like it. I mean, if it's less than the sum of its parts, that's an interesting point. I don't see it personally, but that's, you know, fair enough. And, you know, all these things are subjective. Yep. What do you think, guys? You got anything to add?
I don't know that. The bit that surprised me was when he said where it's missing some heart. I'm thinking, you know, how much heart do you want it to have? It's already got the heart the size of a planet in it. You know, it's. Yeah, I was a little bit taken back by that.
But, you know, that's fine. It's cool.
Yeah.
Well, I have a theory.
Yes.
And this is such an archetypal superhero movie. It probably is prone to a very common syndrome in superhero comics. And that is if you don't like the characters, you won't like the comic.
Yeah.
And let's face it, there's a whole range of superheroes. Some people are bat people, other people are super people, some people like Green Lantern, some people like, you know, Spider-Man.
Mm.
But, you know, other people just can't get on with those characters for whatever reason.
Yeah, that's
you know
very
what I mean.
True.
I think, you know, maybe that's it. You said he didn't relate to the characters and just, you know, the kind of superhero team of the Incredibles just, you know, is one of those just doesn't appeal to him, which, you know, I completely, you know, I read a lot of comics and, you know, I understand that. You know, we all have our characters that you click with and others you go, oh, why do people bother with that twat? And it's you know, it's no reflection on the art or the writing or the storylines or whatever. It's just that those characters don't work for you personally.
Cool.
For whatever reason.
Fairly, really diplomatic there. Diplomatic there. Jim, well done. I was just about to get Tom a whole new wing of the Bunker of Shun. him and one third of, one half of Peter Organ and one third of Anne-Marie could go down there. But anyway, no, thank you very much again for that, Tom. And you can find Tom's blog, which you mentioned earlier, grindhousetom.com. And his podcast is the Twilight Zone podcast.com. There you go, and I'm sure you can find that on iTunes as well. Right, okay. Well, next piece of feedback. He says, opening up his iPad and hoping that he can find it and keep talking and keep sounds. La, 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 la. Is Martin Thompson.
There you go.
Martin Thompson sent us some MP3 feedback.
Dan, hope the audio is fine on this one.
Let's hear what he has to say about The Incredibles.
I thought Wax Cylinder would be the perfect format to record on last time. You know, it has the perfect blend of, you know, hisses and sparks, you know, that really authentic Edwardian feel, but, you know, I guess it didn't work out. So, all right, I'm trying something else this time. Right, The Incredibles. Well, it's only the second time I've seen this film. First time, I thought it was good. It was all right, but not great. Second time around, I've had a better appreciation for it, I have to say. This film is marvellous. It's a really good film. It's so much about it. Every character in it gets to shine, you know, at least once or twice. Every member of the family gets to use their powers to save the rest. It's such a quick, fast-moving film as well. You know, you've got these marvellous little pinch-up moments, you know, Mr. Incredible lifting the car and the kid on the bike, just his bubblegum suddenly pops. And Mr. Incredible's a wonderful figure as well, because, I mean, the entire film seems to be based around him. You know, it's his accidents that lead the superheroes to be sued in the first place. He creates Syndrome, his rejection of Buddy. And that's it. Syndrome made a wonderful little villain. I think he's somebody you really got his motivations for, and somebody who, you know, you could see it there. You know, he wanted to sell his inventions ultimately, so there wouldn't be any superheroes anymore. So everyone could be a superhero, you know, just like he wanted to be. I mean, everything, as well, he's made to, for Mr. Incredible to feel small at the beginning of the film. He's a huge guy. He's cramped into a small car. He's cramped into a cubicle. He's just trying to do good. And it never seems to work out for him. But yeah, when he finally gets into the jungle, he's finally free and he's happy and he's running around. I seem to be describing him a bit like a cocker spaniel. But there was another thing. The Omnidroids, they were brilliant. They were a character in themselves. The whole thing had a whole brilliant scene of retro future cool kind of running through it, like it was taken from the best bits of James Bond. I thought the jungle scene at the end was perhaps a little long, and I don't know really whether you needed that additional scene at the end where Syndrome kidnaps the baby, if only to demonstrate the baby's powers, really. Okay, another thing. I was going to watch this with my niece Eva, 4 years old. So I thought she had plenty to say about it. So I was going to watch this with her, but I got over to her house and found the wonderful two-disc edition is, unfortunately, the disc one seemed to be missing, and I couldn't find it. But I did ask her a bit about it. So here we go. See if you like this small little bit.
Eva, do you like The Incredibles?
Yeah.
Who's your favourite character?
I'm thinking.
You're thinking. All right, what's your favourite bit of The Incredibles?
The baby.
The baby. You like the baby?
Yeah.
Like the baby whizzing about everywhere?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Stop
that. Yeah. Finally, would you like to watch Howard the Duck next week?
Yeah.
Yeah, you'll do. Big space duck from outer space. Directed by George Lucas. Well, she's gone. Oh, there's the thing. Okay, right, I'm trying to think of anything else I might add about the film. Other than that, yeah, I thought it was a,
I really liked it second time around. The teenager Violet as well. I thought she was really good. You know, such a great metaphor as well. She has her hair over her eyes, and she's trying to hide at the beginning of the film, but she's out and confident by the end with a hairband sort of pulling it back. And there's a great ending as well. The Underminer, you know, typical supervillain. And well, of course, this film has given us the whole concept of monologuing. You know, somebody finally put a name to all those long villain speeches. Alright, so, yep, I think that's everything I've got to say on the matter, yep. So, Howard the Duck, next week then. Saw it at some point way back when, on video, and I'm not expecting good things from this one. But we shall see. Okay, thank you very much. Alright, goodbye.
Thank you very much for that, Martin.
Yeah, cheers for that, Martin.
And thank you, Eva.
Mm.
Very good piece of feedback from her, especially the Howard the Duck response. And she's
Howard the Duck. No,
and she's gone. No, I have to say, Martin trying to explain to a 4-year-old the back history of Howard the Duck, Space Duck, George Lucas directed it. She's going to give a shit. 4 years old. Who the fuck is George Lucas? What's a duck? What's space? Brilliant. Dear. Cool. Any thoughts, guys? Feedback?
No. I think raised a good point about the character of Mr. Incredible, because I think in other hands, being a super strong character, that have played him as a big stupid lunk, whereas they actually gave him depth and soul in this, rather than just taking the cheap route.
Yes,
which is again more credit to Mr. Bird.
Indeed. The whole thing with Syndrome kidnapping the kid at the end, I mean, we didn't really cover that in our bit, but I mean, I have to say, thinking about it now, it probably is the only weakest bit of the film for me, because it does kind of have this whole sort of like assumption that Syndrome knows where he lives, actually he does know where he lives, doesn't he, because that's how they find him in the first place. But you know, just that sort of conveniently turning up and stealing the child and running off with it. That, you know, just it's all a little, given how everything else has been nicely constructed, it just seems a little bit sort of tacked on. But it's not a game changer or a killer. It doesn't change my opinion of it too much. But yeah, it's the only bit that I'm thinking about it. It's kind of like, okay, fair enough. One thing before we move on to our last piece of MP3 feedback, thank you very much for that, by the way, Martin, is there was a piece of feedback on Facebook from Rosmosis. And Ros writes, feedback for The Incredibles. Yes, The Incredibles is The Incredibles any good? The short answer is fuck yeah. The long answer is fuck yeah, of course it's good. It's like a blocky diesel punk kettle of superhero loving awesome. I had to say that. I had to practice that once or twice. It's got Brody as the bad guy, a baby who catches on fire in a good way, a female superhero, costumes that are practical and dignifying. It's a family film that doesn't shoot saccharine directly into your eyes. Another bad guy is called Bon Voyage. Seriously, why do people not like this film again? I'm a little scared to listen now. Are there honestly people out there who don't like The Incredibles? It breaks the little art, it's all it does. For me, Pixar seemed to turn out shining examples of animated cinema with reassuring regularity, unlike some major studio animation powerhouses I can mention. DreamWorks! Pixar makes a concerted effort to center its films around characters, adorable one-liners, solid story and amazing visuals, and The Incredibles is no exception. I'd even go so far as to say it's my favourite Pixar film to date. Incidentally, no, I don't think The Incredibles is better than Toy Story. I consider Toy Story trilogy to be an entirely separate league, so there. The Incredibles is a wonderful film. It's a chicken soup, or in my case, tomato soup for the soul, and I can't fault it. I'd be interested to hear why people don't like it, where they live, so I can come and visit.
Let's hope they don't like wearing capes. Revs up plane engine. Stay safe, Rosmosis. P.S. It passes the Bechdel test too, with flying colours. Not always the mark of a good film, but with a little sprinkling of awesome nonetheless. P.P.S. One of my old uni friends is the spitting image of Edna. Weird. There you go. Thank you very much for that. Thank you, Roz.
Oh.
By the way, we're not in the habit of giving out addresses for people to come and pay visit to other people. We have just the bunker of Shun, and they must be put in there, and no one else. We can meter out justice. Also, it means that no one can come and find us if we do the shit films. Yes. Howard the Duck. Right. moving on. Last piece of MP3 feedback is from Dave Jacola of the Inside Out cast, Evil Dave. And I think we may have some bullshit analysis from Dr. Dave.
Your host, Dr.
So,
Dave.
Let's hear what he has to say.
The Incredibles promotes a message that runs counter to that which special interest groups in America have been institutionalizing for years, that everyone is special. Several American schools have ceased using red markers to indicate mistakes on homework, as parent groups feel the color is too angry. Moreover, failing grades such as an F have been eliminated so that the child receiving the grade doesn't have his feelings hurt. Compounding this, every kid is awarded a participation trophy in sports and other so-called competitions, whether or not they won or lost. All this is supposed to build up a child's self-esteem. You know who has great self-esteem? Sociopaths. The people at Pixar understand that there is a distinction to be made between those that can and those that can't. This is a difficult subject to explore, as one can slip into the traps laid by Nietzsche in the Übermensch, or in Ayn Rand's objective egoism and man-worship. The Incredibles avoid these pitfalls by embracing that which the two philosophers condemned, morality. The family of the Incredibles are moral paragons, people who feel a compulsion to help others. This is illustrated not only in Mr. Incredible's rescue of a suicidal man, but in the manner in which he helps with an elderly lady's insurance claim. Even so, there are shadows present. Observe how the masses, what Nietzsche would call the herd and Rand would call parasites, ban the use of superpowers. In metaphorical terms, embittered that they do not also shine, the people make laws to blot out the sun. At the other extreme is Syndrome, who, as a young lad, yearned to be part of the superhero world, yet lacked the talents necessary to do so. He employs technology to fill that gap. Ordinarily, this would be no different from Batman or Iron Man, or even Ant-Man, or a number of other technophiles. Syndrome is not of their ilk, however, as those heroes, too, have something of the special and unique about them. Syndrome no longer aims to elevate his station to hero as much as use technology to level the playing field. When everyone is special, no one is. All the while, the film entertains with its mod 60s design. The comic book humor is spot on, particularly as the film recounts the many cape mishaps, which foreshadow the ending. Additionally, the superpowers are used to great effect, making elastic abilities not only interesting, but fun. Furthermore, Dash's ability to run on water makes for an intense and engaging chase sequence. That Violet gets two defensive abilities, invisibility and a force field, to everyone else's one offensive power is also a nice touch. In sum, The Incredibles deliver what could be an unpopular opinion in today's society, but does so with humor and grace. The gifted should not be compelled to bury their talents in the dirt just to appease the egos of the substandard. Each should be praised for greatness, not awarded for mediocrity. And that's my bullshit analysis.
Wow. Well, thank you very much for that, Dave. Dr. Dave and his bullshit analysis. Basically, taking the unpopular decision of saying some people are special, some people aren't. Do you agree with that, guys?
Some people are special and some people aren't.
Yeah, as opposed to kind of, you know, the usual kind of everyone wins, even if you come 58th kind of thing.
I think that is probably part of society's problem today is the fact that we celebrate fucking idiots. well, we do. I mean, you only have to look at the sort of people. You only have to look at the sort of people who make it famous for doing fuck all apart from just being stupid. You know, in reality television, like Big Brother and stuff like this. That's the way we've gone now. And it's, you know, it shouldn't be that way. You know, if you were just like, I mean, just have a lack of common sense, you were ridiculed for it. You know, but these days it's kind of like that's the in and cool thing to be. It's so I think he's got a point there.
Cool. Okay, cool. And Jim, you got anything to add, or...?
No, I go along with that, and I go along with Dave's analysis. Because the thing is, one of the big curses, I think, of the whole animated, computer-animated new wave of kids' films is, and as people pointed out, is they often fall back on, hey, kids, just be yourself and everything be all right. Kind of very bland message, and it's a good message, but it's one of these things. Well, yeah, it's easy to be general and like that, but you know, if you're Jack the Ripper, don't be yourself. Be somebody else, maybe, you know.
Strive to be better.
I think it's, you know, there is a line to be drawn between, say, wanting things that, as Louis C.K. would say, yes, of course we want equality. But maybe some people are twats, you know. And The Incredibles, it'd be very easy. So in other hands, it would be there would be a moral to the story, is that they had to be true to themselves and be heroes. But it doesn't actually push that line at all. It is as Dave says. It says, you know, they are exceptional, and it is about people trying to grind them down to not be exceptional. It's far more interesting for it, and I think that's why people love this film, because it doesn't boil things down to these moral platitudes. It actually, there are difficult questions and dark things
just
in
there. The surface, yeah.
Maybe it says something about like, you know, a jealousy in society that those are actually special. You know, jealousy from those people who don't have those abilities and who let it get to them, you know, and feel somehow that they're owed something like that.
Well, we talked earlier about the fanboy entitlement thing, and that is the jealousy of, well, I like your stuff, and therefore I'm equal to you because I get it.
Yeah.
Whereas, no, they created it. You lapped it up. There's a difference, Sonny.
Yeah, there's a difference between making Batman and making Batman slash fiction. Not a lot, I'd grant you, in some comic book cases, but, it, you know, yes, there is some difference. Cool. Well, excellent. Well, if you want to carry that conversation on, if anyone wants to bring up any other points raised by Dave or anyone in this podcast, by all means, drop them on the Facebook group. And let's carry on that conversation, to nick the questions little phrase. So, there you go, wrapping it up. I think I have to say, I think overall, The Incredibles, big thumbs up, and I think most people agree to a certain degree. Or,
oh, definitely.
Yeah. So, we must move on. We must wrap this up, but we must move on and tell you what is next week's film, if you hadn't already guessed. And also our previous memories of this film as well. So, next week's film is what has now become part of our superhero season, I guess, isn't it? I suppose we're going into a superhero season at this rate.
I suppose we are. Have we got any superhero movies apart from Man of Steel? There you go.
Well, Iron Man's out next week.
It's next week, is it?
Yeah, next week in the UK.
Almighty, yeah, time flies.
There you go. So there you go. Not in the States, though, so we'll have to wait a week and then do it and then cover it. But anyway, so yes, so we are going to do Howard the fucking Duck. Please don't look up Howard the fucking Duck, because you will end up with all sorts of weird imagery. However, it is Howard the Duck. one of George Lucas's earliest missteps before we even got as far as Jar Jar freaking Binks. So, Jim, Darren, what were your earliest memories of Howard the Duck? And do you think that this week's shit cover goggles will be removed and you might have an epiphany?
My earliest memories of Howard the Duck, well, if you're talking about from watching it, it was only a few years ago.
Oh, yeah.
Actually, when we were doing, before the Blackdog podcast actually sort of like began, we did the Bad Movie Club on Twitter with a few people, and we got sent some films.
Yeah, and, by Rob the Chief.
Yeah, by Rob the Chief. And one of those was, I think that was the only one we did, wasn't it? Howard the Duck, and yeah. It kind of died a death.
Well, that was because the most known of the four films on that disc, and we just couldn't face any more if they were going to be worse.
No, yeah. I actually, just to see that, you know, my copy was working, I put it on and I started watching it, and I got the same fucking creeping feeling that I did with Super Mario Brothers, you know. it was just,
yeah.
It's one of those things where you have like a really bad accident and your memory kind of, you know, hides those details from you, because I can't really remember that much from watching it last time. If I remember rightly, I think I just drifted off and went and did something else, like build some potatoes or something.
I do recall you getting on the forum and getting really, really angry that we were making you watch this. I remember that.
Was it me or was it someone else?
No, it was you. I just sat there laughing at it. But anyway. Right, okay, so Jim, have you seen Howard the Duck before?
I saw it on its original release in cinemas.
Ah, you lucky, lucky man.
You fucking finance this piece of shit.
Like it in here. I'm afraid I did.
Christ almighty, Jim.
At the time, our local cinema was a quid to get in.
The old
cheap
ticket.
I went to see everything. Mm. But even so, I have to say I felt ripped off. But, you know, it was... in the UK, it went out as Howard, a new breed of hero.
Yeah.
Which, it was a new breed of something.
You advertised it almost like a warning, like hepatitis B is in your area. It's a new breed. Yeah, it's just like, nice. So,
well, you know, and also back then, you know, we thought George Lucas was some wunderkind. We didn't know the real truth that actually most of the good things in Star Wars weren't by his hands. And I found it difficult to believe it was the same guy who had made this a terrible, terrible film, but a thoroughly, bizarrely terrible film at that. I mean, I was aware of the Marvel comics of Howard the Duck. I hadn't read any.
Mm.
But even from what little I knew of the character, I knew this had gone horribly, horribly wrong.
Cool. And are you looking forward to watching it this time? Okay.
Connection's gone off.
Yeah. Skype call has been dropped. Yeah, boom, boom, boom. Yeah, taking the Eevee route out there, I notice.
No!
Oh, dear. My earliest memory of Howard the Duck was seeing it so racked up on sugar and disappointment. Because I'd read a few comics when I was going through my sort of, like, read everything phase. When my dad used to come home and he used to sort of stop off at a newsagent, he used to just get like every comic and just throw them at me when he came through the door on the Friday night. And Howard the Duck was kind of this weird way out comic, so I was quite looking forward to the film, believe it or not. And I was saying to Jim off air, I was just saying that basically it just felt like I've just been constantly smashed in the face with disappointment. It's like I just watched a 2-hour film where basically you see your pet cat buried in concrete very slowly. The last, just before the credits roll, his whiskers go under and his ears disappear. But the one thing I always remember is sitting there watching it, and then all of a sudden, Jeffrey Jones, who we now know is a rampant pedo, at the time was kind of a big popular thing, kind of Ferris Bueller and all that kind of thing. And he turns up as the villain in this cafe, and I think he just says something, and I can't even remember what it was, but I always remember basically breaking into a fit of giggles for about 20 minutes off the back of that one scene. And I can't work out if it was hysteria, a huge sugar content, or the fact that my brain had gone into shutdown and hallucinated something else equally funny.
I vote to shut down.
Yeah, I'm fairly sure it was something like that. So my abiding memory, apart from that thing a couple of years back with Rob, but is just finding it like numbing, grueling and numbing, and ever so slightly hysterical for about 20 minutes for reasons I can't quite fathom. So I have no idea what I'm going to be getting into this time around. I'm kind of fearful, because if I start liking it or laughing at it again, then I know I've lost my mind entirely. I think this enforced sort of redundancy thing has finally cracked me, and actually it'll be like the end of The Descent. I'll actually be laughing away, thinking I'm talking and watching a film, and this, in fact, this podcast, none of this is going on. I'm actually about a quarter of a mile underground staring at my own torch as it's going out, aren't I? That's what's going on right now. So yeah, that's Howard the Duck. Looking forward to that. So if anybody else would like to watch Howard the Duck and send us some feedback in, please send it in to blackdog@geekplanetonline.com, or leave it for us on the Facebook group, which is facebook.com/groups/theblackdogpodcast, or just wrap it around a large gold brick and throw it through my window. So that's it. That's the end of this cast. Thank you all for listening. Thank you, Jim, for once again taking part in this weirdness.
My pleasure.
And Ed, would you like to do a little bit of advertising of your wares, sir?
Yes.
Well, then go right ahead.
Yes, you can hear Hypnobobs on iTunes or Geek Planet Online, and also on hypnagoria.com, where you can find links to everything else I do. And do go buy my book, available for Kindle, The Seven of Spectres, a selection of vintage ghost stories, with more volumes coming out soon.
Lovely. There you go.
Do you have a release date for the next one, Jim?
I did do, until my bathroom fucked up.
The Seven of Spectres, Volume 2, The Bathroom Fucked Edition. You should find a story about a man menaced by plumbing and put that in. I'm sure there is one.
Great idea.
M.R. James's The Plumber or something. I don't know if he did one like that. But
Round the Bend.
I actually wrote one called The Leak many years ago.
Nice. There you go. Yeah.
Probably shit, but never mind.
Dark water.
Yeah, well, yes.
Yeah, there you go.
Hot dog flavoured water.
No. Oh, God. Okay, and with that, thank you, everyone. Thank you all for listening. Thank you, Jim, for taking part. Depending on how things go, we might get you back for Howard the Duck.
Oh, I'd love to talk about Howard the Duck.
I think that'll be great. And thank you, Darren, for staying awake.
Not a problem.
I love that delay. Love that delay. It was just like, what? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, and we'll see you all next week for Howard the Goddamn Fucking Duck. Cheers! Bye!
Bye.